sit down. Coming out of PE town. Want a drink, find a shot. Never mind your liver, get to Gino Spot.
Gino Spot.
Get to Gino Spot.
Gino Spot.
Have a laugh, have a giggle, and exercise your middle. Have a Gino shot.
Gino Spot.
Get to Gino Spot.
Gino Spot.
Get to Gino Spot.
Gino Spot.
Have a laugh, have a giggle, and exercise your middle. Get to Gino Spot.
Gino Spot.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Gino Spot. You can see by my outfit tonight, I'm heading back into the 80s because we're going to chat to Gavin Hogg about some 70s and 80s and 90s. We're going to head back into his history and have a look at see what's going on. This is my 70s outfit, baby. What do you think? Yeah. So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome. Thursday. It's been a lovely week. Beautiful evening. This evening as well in Klebecha. The Bechis are out in Klebecha having a beautiful time in the this evening. And they're hopefully watching Gino Spot instead of Sona, because I think Sona is very, very boring. And we'll just have to look at News 24. We hope that you're all having a good time at home. You've got something to drink. It's evening. It's time to just put your feet up. Just get a little glass of something and tell me what you're drinking. Tell me what you got in your glass, because I've got a little bit of Fitchinese. I went for a whiskey and soda. The Fitchinese has got a lovely little soda that we put in. Mike from Furen says, give it large horns, Gav, he says. Gav's backstage here at the moment. We're going to have a good time with him. And don't forget, he's got some reminders for him there. We'll check. Wendy Thompson. Hello, Wendy Thompson. Lovely to see you online as well. Wendy's, of course, been roped in as well. Some of our regulars have been roped in to help with the show too, because it's because one if people watch the show, then at least it's an interactive show. So not only interactive in terms of comments, but if you want to help and join in, then you can also just do something too. Sharon Myberg is watching as well. How's it, Sharon? We're going to sing you in. Thank you to our sponsors, of course, Fitch and Leeds and Spar, who've been absolutely fantastic. Angelo and the guys, and Stapes. And I think Stapes has he's been sick for a bit. I think he's got a stomach ailment. We want Stapes to get better, get well soon, buddy. We hope that it's all going to be okay. I think he had some sort of lip allergy. I think he had an allergy, and his lips were really big today on Facebook. I saw that. Nice pic, Stapes, but we hope you get better soon, and I hope that all this cuck stops for you very shortly. Thank you, of course, also for our food tonight. We've got Fat Cats. Grace from Fat Cats gave us a little bit of food, as she does on a Thursday. Thank you. Thursday is eating day for the Gino Spot Studio, which is great. All right, so let me see you, and let me know what's going on in the comments. Don't be shy. Stick a comment in. If you want to know anything from Gav as well, obviously stick a question in. Trigger his memory about any story you want to hear, and tell me what you're drinking. Tell me where you're watching from. That's what I want to know. We always have from all over the world. We have people from London, from New Zealand. Oh! Amor, pipitupa, Sharon, my burger, Wendy Swanell, watching all the way from Titsikama. Ronald Minar, you got up early this morning, watching from New Zealand. Camilla Ellis, nice to have you too, from the library. Ooh, and Karl Baumeister is on too tonight. He's coming on soon. I'm not sure what date's right. Every day and every night. Gary tells me it's the fourth too soon. Having a glass of wine, says Lynn Sigger. Amor, pipitupa, love the sparkly shirt. Thank you very much. Does it turn you on? Sean Sanan, how's it, Gavin? Watching from Oxford. Dab 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 dab. Thelma Jean, Badenhorst. Says hello from Durban. How is it in Durban? Very nice. Dolly Hibbard says hello too. What you drinking? And Roxy Parkazin is in the house. Ba-da-da! All right, Roy says, go, Uncle Gavin. Go, Uncle Gavin, says Roxy. Lovely to have you all on board. Lots of people up tonight. We're going to put our feet up and have a bit of a relaxing time because hell, we deserve it. It's Thursday. And you know what that means? It's nearly Friday. All right. So you don't have to go to work tomorrow. I'm just telling you. Yeah, it's fine. You don't even worry about it. Except for guys, of course, that work for Gavin. Yeah, they have to go to work. But other guys, you guys don't have to worry. It's easy. Let us know where you're from as well. Punters, yes, of course. We've got a bit of gin and tonic here for a little bit later when I need my sugar. And so I've got a little bit of punters. Casey, I hope you're watching. We've got some punters. It's running. It's about halfway now. We're okay. We're okay for about two more shows. It depends who's on, you know. We'll see how much gin Gavin drinks. All right, so ladies and gentlemen, of course it is time now to have our guest on. But before we do that, we're going to thank one of our sponsors, and that is Fitch and Leeds. So let us get our guest on while we watch Fitch and Leeds.
Fitch and Leeds, you've got to mix it, that'll fix you on the table.
Fitch and Leeds, the bespoke mixer for the discerning individual.
And we are almost in. Here we go. We're going to get your mics next to you here. Gav, welcome to the studio. Let me put you.
Thank you, Gino.
Can you guys hear him? Can you hear Gavin? Give us the thumbs up if we got him here. Let's just make sure that we put this out of the way a little bit so it doesn't interfere with him. You need to look good, you know what I mean? I don't know.
That's long gone.
You know, if it's depending on where you put the mic, depending, it could be slimming or not so slimming, yeah, you know.
Too late.
Gavin Hogg, fantastic to have you on.
And nice to be here. Privileged. Thanks, Gino.
Fantastic. We've had you on the radar for a while because a lot of your, we've had quite a few people in, you know, and your name's come up here and there.
Probably, you know, from the clowns I hang around
with. I'm sure. And it's lovely. I mean, I know you've got a lot of people online as well tonight. So please send in your comments too. And we'll get Gary to put them up. He's adjusting cameras and things for the interview. You get your best side.
There isn't one.
But Gavin, you've become synonymous with Cerebos. I know that, you know, but there's a whole other story to your life, which I've discovered over the last few days because we've been chatting to your mates, you know. and at the moment, what are you busy with at this very moment?
At this very moment, I've handed over the reins for head of sales to a colleague of mine who's been with me through my agency business and through Cerebos, Kevin Duckworth.
Okay.
Has taken over of head of sales of Cerebos.
Okay.
And Cerebos have allowed me to move on to new challenges.
Yeah, yeah.
Designed to take the brand Cerebos that has been with me for more than 40 years.
Yeah.
To different places. We're looking to launch products into different categories.
Okay.
So
different products and stuff as well.
While salt is obviously always going to be our core business.
Yeah.
The new products that we're developing through an old friend of ours, an ex-spar man himself, Graham Clarkson, you might remember.
Graham Clarkson and I have known very well.
The famous GC.
You know, if there's a party happening, Graham is always the last one to leave.
And a lot of trouble to go with it. is helping us develop some new products that will enhance the Cerebos brand into new categories. We're very excited. The Cerebos Sauce range, which did exist many years ago, has been reinvented, and we're testing that, and Spa have already on board with us, and we hope to get into the other top end retailers fairly soon. But we have some other big plans for other categories, which the public will see soon.
Oh, it's quite exciting then.
No, very exciting for me. But Cerebos, very exciting for Cerebos.
Is it I mean, I know there's a big plant here in Eastern Cape, but is it originally an Eastern Cape thing? Was it a national thing? Or where's Cerebos? No, international?
Firstly, the brand Cerebos originates from the UK.
Okay.
And the brand is actually still owned by a UK company.
Oh, right. Okay.
We happen to own the rights to the Cerebos brand in perpetuity here in sub-Saharan Africa.
Okay.
So yeah, we're able to produce that beautiful product here locally. When you talk about has it been here forever, yes, it has been here forever. It's been here, I don't even remember.
The salt pans,
I'm desperate to not say it's been here as long as I've been alive, but it's a lot longer than that actually. And And it did start here in PE.
Kaiku looped it, says Mark Banks. Mark, yeah. Nice to see you online as
see
well.
You, Jones.
Where are you in Darling? Let us know where you're coming from. Gabby, we're watching, says Gail.
Gaily, one of my wife's best friends. In fact, the next flatmate of hers.
Oh, excellent, excellent. One of those mates that they drink wine with. Is that the one?
Yeah.
Okay. Lynn Dumpier says, Ara Gino and Gavin, this should be fun indeed. We are hoping so, because I found there's some tasty morsels that I've heard about Gav as well.
Yeah, Ian Lee is a big problem. We should discuss him a little bit later.
So the pharmacist, eh? He hands out the drugs.
Yeah, hands out drugs and other things.
Ian Lee, of course, from Ian Robertson. Everybody confuses him with Ian Robertson.
Well, they probably look the same. Same, not the same age, but they're looking identical.
Our local pharmacist, Glenn Bronze, said, how's it?
There's my MD.
John D. How's it, John?
John Drinkwater, that's my John MD. And a man who holds the reins for the brand that has become synonymous with my name.
Okay. So, I presume also, I think I knew a Peter Drinkwater that was with Dean Marquez.
Aubrey Cullum, ex-Pirates hockey player. Gav for Sona. As you said earlier, Sona's not that important right now, surely.
Boring. Boring as hell. Look at News 24 afterwards. They'll give you the rundown. You have to watch it now. It's just going to be lots of long and boring speeches, whereas here, you can hear something interesting. So, marvelous comments coming up here. I see you watching from Mud Lane. It says Sharon Myberg as well. Abu Dhabi.
Yeah, Rob Gill, ex-tennis partner of ours.
Lovely.
Played tennis with him at the Oval Tennis Club for quite a few years.
Now, those guys could drink.
Had the worst forehand I've ever seen in my life.
Really?
Yeah.
Remember the time Pudge and myself crushed you in Bruce O'Long?
Blanked it out of my memory.
Oh, really? It was in the 80s and the 90s. Can't you let it go, Rob?
Yes, let it go, for God's sake. Oh, actually, classic. Because he couldn't let it go, we sent him to Abu Dhabi.
Oh, just a dog. Off you go. Yeah. Wendy, think you'll have fun with Gavin? Absolutely. I think so, Wendy. And Sharon Mai, we're watching from Malelane.
Good heavens, Sharon.
Where is Malelane? Is that up in Joburg?
That's one of my wife's best friends from school.
Excellent.
Recently helped my wife share a 50th school anniversary or whatever you want to call it down there at Fish River.
Lovely girl. Ruth. There we go. There's another chap we need to get on as well. Ross Clements, Gavin, my son.
Ross Clements, my dad. There's no doubt about that. That man, if I could talk about him for a second.
Ooh.
That man got me involved in rugby when I moved to PE after I'd given it up.
Wow.
He got me involved in the Springbok Stein Club, which is a club
story.
That possibly should be kept to one side.
Stein in wine, as in wine.
But the one thing about Ross Clements that I will always hold very dear to myself is the way he has brought fellowship to hundreds of thousands of people in this PE community of ours. He has brought fun at Pirates. He was the founder member of the Stein Club. Back in the 60s, he was the founder member of Pirates Buccaneers side, which is the old man side that keeps those guys, the Bucks, that keep guys who want to give up hockey. It keeps them back in the game.
Okay.
He is a legend of immense proportion.
Yes.
He got me involved in the Saders 4B rugby side, and I'll
4B.
Never forget. My first game for that side, the opposition failed to pitch. And so I was ready to go home or at least go to the pub upstairs at Saders, and I was bundled into a car, forced to go all the way out to Woodridge. And I was told I was going to be having a bit of fun at the fete. So you can imagine my
the
long
Woodridge
look.
Fair.
They even took me to this place where you had to do those magnets and fish for fish because I was complaining bitterly.
Oh,
until
dear.
They took me to the real part of the Woodridge Fair, which was the
beer tent. Yes.
And came home at 12 o'clock.
Oh, no, no.
That was beautiful fun. He is my dad. He's a wonderful man. I love him to bits. And SA Breweries were very lucky to have that man in there. Yeah. There's no doubt about that.
So Ross was with SA.
Still a special man. He still takes me on the odd pub crawl.
Yeah. Oh, does he?
He's still mad, that man.
So he can still go. He's still going at it.
Far
it's
better
like
than
Graham,
I can.
It's like Graham McLaughlin as well. Also, not a problem there. Oh, man. I see Ian Lee saying, did you spill some salt on your hair there? So that's cheeky. Yeah? That's very cheeky.
Ian Lee.
Oh, man. So you're saying, okay, so at the moment you're looking at the new, like a new project.
A new product, Kevin will look after the core Cerebos business.
The factory from there, is it local, or is it you bringing the sources and stuff in?
No. We are using third party packers some of our all of our products outside of the salt category. But that salt that we produce here, when we did the management buyout, probably around about 2000, that wasn't the most difficult part of the journey that Lightning Leonard Chandler took us on at the time. Kelly Chandler, to most of the people watching tonight, will know him as Kelly. Yes. I know him as Len or Lightning Leonard.
Yeah.
He was the one that brought three or four of us into that management buyout. And made it very easy for us to do so.
Yeah.
The big challenge was when we spent a heap of money building that new plant, which then made it possible for us to produce a product that is incredible. It's a first world product. It is it's done in a completely different way to any competitor that we have in Africa, and it really is a Rolls Royce a product. And I think the brand has a lot to thank Kelly for, because that was a chance that was taken at a time when most people weren't prepared to take chances. We stood on the precipice quite often, but Len made sure that I got kicked out of most board meetings early enough to never know that. All I was told to do was go and sell.
Oh my word.
And never knew how close we were to the precipice from time to time, but he saw us through those troubled times, and the rest is history.
You know, I love it when people talk about that sort of thing, because it doesn't matter how big your business is, how well you perceive to be doing it, it's always, you've got to be at it all the time. Otherwise, things can go wrong so quickly.
And Gino, you've got to have balls, my man. And Lightning Leonard certainly had balls to take us through that. But today, and I have to say that the brand has been with me for more than 40 years. It is incredible when I look back. But while we had many great sales teams looking after that brand, I have to be honest that the brand right now is in the safest hands it's ever been. We belong to the Bud Group.
Yeah.
The Bud Group now own us along with many other companies. We're probably
the beer bunch.
No, not Budweiser.
Okay.
We're much wiser than that.
Okay, you're talking about Bud as in Rosebud.
No. But the Bud Group does own us. We're part of the Bud Chemical Group. It's the safest place our brand's ever been. And I've got to be honest with you, Gina. That's probably the second last time I'm going to be serious tonight.
Okay. Excellent.
Can I have some soda?
Yes, absolutely. Have some more
some
soda.
Some Fitchingly.
There we go. Here's some more soda and some more ice here as well. We've got some ice if you need as well.
Thank you.
There we go. You have to grab some. Because we've had it sanitized.
With purity, hand sanitizer, hopefully. Not purity, purist. Yeah, purist. How much have you had?
Purist. The purest of the pure.
Yeah.
That brand as well is like Mark was saying, the chicken and the cake and whoop say.
You have no idea how many times we've received letters threatening us because we're so cruel to animals.
Cruel to animals.
Yeah.
No. Is it still on the thing? Is it still on it? I mean, it just...
It is. It's hard to remove something like that from an iconic brand like Cerebos. Some of our newer diversions in terms of product category, we've removed it. But our core brand, it's got to stay there. It's what it is. It is what it is.
It's really...
Imagine taking it off. I mean, people wouldn't...
Do you know if there's a story behind that thing or anything? I don't even know.
It's an old wives' tale that if you... And it's quite a sad one, actually. Is if you needed to stop a chicken so you could slaughter it, you threw salt on its tail.
Well, fortunately, that one was getting away.
Yeah,
it's fine. Salt on its tail. Oh, no,
I don't even know how true that is.
No, I don't think so. I think that chick is going to run a mile. But so that's your thing at the moment, and it's nice to have a new project, something that you can get passionate about.
Yeah.
Because I think you...
Especially at my age. Yes, it's hard to get challenges these days.
You know.
I'm at that age where people that are at my age now are the people I used to laugh at when I was 30.
No, those old buggers.
Yeah, those old fools.
Holy crap! Oh no. And it's being with a company for that long is crazy though. It's like because you become intertwined in that whole organization.
There's no doubt, Gino.
I saw somebody putting a thing, Glenn Brown, saying a great privilege to work with Gavin and the Cerebos team as the execution partner. Oh, there. Were you the one that chases those chickens around?
Glenn, how's it, bud?
There we go. And, Timothy Peak.
Timothy Peak. I've got a story about that man. Yes. And the man that's just taken over as head of sales of Cerebos. That Timothy Peak took Kevin Duckworth and myself to a conference in the Berg.
Yeah.
Quite a few years ago when I still had my agency business. So it is a long time ago. Sure. And anyway, we were invited to this conference. And I've always been told that night one, stay calm.
Yes.
But I've never been able to convert that into practice. And night one has always been the biggest party of the lot.
Good advice, night
one. So the first working day has always been the hardest because you've got to carry this massive hangover. And,
yes.
But this particular one was more difficult than most because the night before, I was set up by Timothy Pike and Kevin Duckworth quite badly where I was forced to tell one specific joke.
Yes.
On a number of occasions.
Okay.
To the same group with maybe one or two add-ons, but the joke itself had to do with a guy who had a cleft palate.
Oh.
And it was, I'm not going to tell the joke because it doesn't belong on this platform, but it was sort of, I told that joke 5 or 6 times and was encouraged vociferously by Duckworth and Peak to tell the story. What I didn't know was the first speaker the next morning had a cleft palate.
Oh, no.
And Duckworth dived under the table. Oh. Timothy Peak left the room. Oh, dear. And I was eternally embarrassed, and we probably lost the account because of it.
You know, you've got to know when and how to tell a joke, you know, as a comedian.
Well, I thought I was about to enter into your market because people were laughing flat out, but they weren't laughing at the joke.
They were laughing at the fact that you were in cuck. Yes, exactly. You got cancelled eventually then as well. Oh, that's so bad. That's so bad.
That is bad. And Timothy Peak must get off this platform.
Yes, he was. Honestly, where have you got friends like that?
No, he needs to go to confession and that stuff.
Go to confession, young man. It's ridiculous. And then
there's Taryn Hogg, my daughter.
Yes,
that's my dad. You see?
That's my dad. What a legend! I see that.
Love it a bit. She's in Cape Town.
And Michael's saying, how's it as well? Michael, is it Saki?
Mike Saki must be in New Zealand at the moment.
All the best from New Zealand. He must be up early.
Yes, left us, you know, while we're trying to get big business together in our networking program.
Oh, right, yes.
Michael could have been a big asset to us, but now he ran away.
Yeah. No.
Michael?
You could have been with us, yeah.
Yes, fool.
Mike Raddick saying, how's it as well?
Mike Raddick was at school with me in East London, at De La Salle.
Now lives in the UK. Rob Jones, how's it, Rob?
My bloody brother. There you go.
Kenny Cooper from Malawi. I think it's probably the first person from
Good
Malawi
heavens.
We've had on the show.
But he's originally from PE, Ken.
Oh, excellent. They spread themselves.
I'm surprised he's in Malawi at the moment.
Yeah, tell us what you're doing in Malawi as well. We want to find out how people end up in these places. Hoggy, you've got a face for radio. Give it horns.
It's Mark Hunter-Smith, one of my neighbours at the Sardinia Bay Golf Estate. Yeah.
Some good Albany English coming through there.
I see Gavin Loon's there.
Gavin.
Always had him in my pocket when I was bowling.
You know.
Easy peasy.
Gavin, he's got a story, and I think some of his mates are going to bring it up. It's something about a curry story. but you'll hear about that later.
Watching from Nars, there, that's where he belongs.
Come on, Warmer, we're here. I think actually, Gav's, folks that were up? No, it was Conlon's. The Conlon's were up the road here as well. But Gav used to be in 14th Avenue Warmer. We used to play rugby together in the backyard.
Gav Loon?
Yeah, absolutely.
Could he play rugby?
He was a bit of a player, you know. He's a player in many, many respects.
Always a pretty dresser. Slides uphill. I know that.
Yeah. Snappy.
Kevin asked you to ask about the Calcutta.
Yes, Calcutta Crapper, I think it was.
Oh, God.
He did ask about
that. Listen, there's quite a few people that have sent me WhatsApps about that, but...
Calcutta Crapper.
Yeah. You
know, he said, ask Gavin about the Calcutta Crapper. So tell me a little story here. Let's get this out of the way.
In 1991, as you know, South Africa first got back into international cricket.
Ah, yes. India.
My good friend GC, Graham Clarkson, was invited by Jeff Dakin, who at that time had an agency business in PE. Jeff did.
Yes.
And Graham was working for DF Scott at the time.
Okay. The painter, or was it just DF Scott?
He was the buyer at DF Scott. No, DF Scott was a big cash and carry business.
Cash and carry, okay.
Run by the Pizzolatti brothers.
Okay.
And Graham was their buyer. Sure. And Jeff invited Graham to join him.
Yes.
Jeff at the time was president of the South African Cricket Union.
Okay.
And we had been invited back by India into international cricket. It was a big thing.
Okay.
Clarkson was invited and was cheeky enough to say, yeah, Jeff, I'll go, but on condition that my mate can come with. But God bless his cotton socks. It took my wife, I must be honest, yes. my lovely wife, Blondie,
yes,
Hazel, convinced me to go because, I mean, I didn't have a passport, I didn't have the money,
No, for a moment, I thought that Jeff was going to take your wife.
Yeah. Anyway, she convinced me that I couldn't miss the opportunity. Okay. And Jeff had conceded. We both going, so we went.
Good.
And the drama started at what was then Jan Smuts Airport.
Okay, yes.
When there was a lot of quaffing of beer.
Yes.
And we bumped into the world-famous Trevor Quirk.
Oh, yes. Yes, and he's been in trouble a few times on my show as well.
The late SA Brewery marketing man, Norman Minot.
Okay.
And Norman advised GC and I that he had 250 cases of beer on board that SAF Air flight that was taking us to India. And we were very excited about that.
Yes.
GC and I immediately offered our services to distribute
the
250 cases of Castle.
Yes.
We got on this plane and we drank all the way to, I think it was the Seychelles. I was a bit out of it by the time we landed. But I remember the first mistake, or the first thing that Clarkson did to cause drama was we stole an army jeep on the apron at the airport in Seychelles.
Yes, that was a good idea, Graham.
It was a very good idea.
Really good idea.
And it was only part of the story, but we were arrested and nearly sent home.
Oh,
and
great.
I think Ali Bacha saved us from being sent home.
Oh, shit.
And we then continued our journey to Calcutta and we continued our drinking. And about 2 hours outside of Calcutta or from Calcutta, GC suggested that maybe I should look to use the ablution facilities on the plane.
Yes.
I suggested that maybe we should have one more beer,
yes,
which I did. And then by the time we'd finished that beer, the queue was right down the plane and it was too late.
Oh, jeez.
We landed and I now needed
the
ablution facilities quite badly.
Yes.
But what I didn't realize was going to happen was that the Indians decided that they needed to spray us. And get rid of all the infection that we were bringing in from Africa.
Right. Yes, of course.
So that took an hour. So you can imagine now there was a drama because now the beer was definitely making some noises and it needed to be removed.
Yes, get out of there.
But I had no idea where I was going.
Oh, my word.
I said to GC, no, I think I can hang on till we get inside. And we eventually went through passport control, took another hour or so. And I was now desperate.
I can't.
But now I'm sweating blood.
Yes.
I made it to the toilets with seconds to spare.
Okay.
And there were a couple of holes in the ground.
Yes.
Like, not the kind of ablution facility.
Yes,
no,
you stand in there and you stand.
And 4 million Indians had beaten me to it and had all missed.
Oh, gee whiz.
So
the first guy from Africa in there.
So I wasn't getting involved in that lot, so I thought I could hang on. And I got out to the buses and asked the first bus driver that was taking the team and us back to the hotels how far it was. He said 15 Ks and I thought, I can make that. If anybody ever saw the TV programs on that cricket trip, you will know that the welcome that we got from the Indian crowds
was
unbelievable. Yeah. And I reckon 4 million Indians met our buses our buses.
Yeah.
The entire road to the hotel was a nightmare.
No.
It was another 3 hours, 4 hours before we got there. So at a point on that trip, I got off the bus.
Yes.
And asked a cop that was escorting us
where the nearest toilet was.
If he could get me to a hotel in a hurry. And he said, do you need to go to the toilet, sir? And I said, yes, I did. Immediately.
Immediately.
Anyway, he took me into this little... It was a shanty. We were in Calcutta. He took me into the shanty. The guy's shop was in the front. There was a few beads. And he took me into the back. But I had no time to discuss where I was going. I found another hole at the back of this house. And I did what I had to do. Yeah. And I looked up and the entire family was watching me. Mother, daughter, the lot. That wasn't even the biggest drama. The biggest drama was now I didn't know what to do because... Yeah. So now, how do we clean up?
Yeah.
And I looked at the family and said, well, now what? And they looked at me and said, well, what are you after, bud? There was a bucket of water next to me, but I thought, well, I'm not doing that.
Yeah.
So I used a Playboy hanky from my Playboy deodorant days.
Yes.
And I cleaned up and I thought I'd do the right thing.
Yes.
And I threw this bucket of water down the slute to clean up everything.
Yes.
That's when the guy who owned the place lost his sense of humor.
Oh, so it's the wrong thing to do.
No. Because he had fetched that from the Ganges.
Oh.
That was at 4 o'clock in the morning he fetched that water. Wow. And that was his water for the day.
Oh, no.
So he chased me. And I literally had to run. I ran for my life into the crowd. 4 million Indians.
Yeah.
And there was my bus. Gone.
Oh, no. They left you behind.
I didn't know what to do. I kept running because this guy was going to kill me. And eventually there was this hand on my shoulder and it was the cop who had waited for me. And he pulled me back in, put me into this Land Rover.
Yeah.
And all I said to him was, listen, my bud, there's no need for more drama. Just take me to the hotel.
Yeah.
But he didn't. He raced after our bus, cut it off.
Oh, no. Drama.
Made me get into the bus and Clarkson, along with Clive Rice and half the team, because we were all split up into different buses, and all of them had been taught this beautiful song called the Calcutta Crapper.
Oh,
and they sang it to me. That's that stupid story.
Right.
Years later, the Pat Simcox told that story at a cricket dinner. And I knew for a fact that he was never there when this happened. But he told it as if he had been on that trip.
You need material.
I cornered him in the bar afterwards and I said, you weren't there for that story. And he said, well, how do you know? I said, because I am the Calcutta Crapper.
That's so classic. My word. You know, I've bumped into...
Now, can I just say something to those fools?
Yes.
It's over now. It's finished.
It's finished.
You that story is
now.
Over.
He's told it now. I gave... Sydney Stickles says, I gave from the head butter. What is that?
I'm not sure, but he was the head butter. He was a crazy tackler at my in our first team at De La Salle. That guy could. He was another Manikis Roo. So I'm sure he's talking about that because I definitely wouldn't headbutt. My best fight was over 100 yards.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, because I could get away from
him
quickly.
You can run. Viv Jacobs, how's it, Viv? Yep. Viv and Artie.
Is it Viv?
Do a cooking show. Do you cook a bit?
What did she say? Should we do a cooking show?
Yeah, a cooking show together, as you're saying.
Not sure. Chandler, there he is.
Kelly Chandler.
Lightning Leonard Chandler.
There's it. Lightning Leonard. And
Sniffersacky.
Sniffersacky, is that he said?
Our wicket keeper and the ex-head of our...
Carla Giacani, of course, I actually had a... Carla was Vestic, is that right?
Yes, he's still there.
Vestic. He did some good backing vocals for a song I did.
I'd love to hear that.
Him and Tracy.
Call me, get him on. Yeah, I'd love to hear them.
I might have the video somewhere, but we'll see. We'll chat about that, Carlo.
You're a beautiful man. I still go on golf tours with Carlo and Gav Loon and a few of the boys.
Alvin Reeves, my old head boy.
Yes, he must write properly in the newspaper, please, but spell properly.
Is it Oggy? And Bruce Long saying, don't
Bruce Long, my world famous tennis partner from the Oval.
All I say is the Oval drink a lot.
Yes, they
Monique
did.
Monique Besson, how's it, Monique? She does the framing. Anybody
Monique
needs framing to be done as well. Carl Baumeister, he's coming on. Hogwash, looking good. Needs some warmer stories.
Carl's actually a great warmer man. Obviously, sadly, no longer there.
Yeah, and warmer country club,
Was the reason why I ended up at Old Grey, which is another story altogether. But warmer... When it was an incredible country club. And when you see a guy like Carl Baumeister making a comment, it brings back memories of what club cricket was really all about in the days when Carl and Rudy Bryson and Harold Donaghy and Chris Kennedy were around. Yeah. We were very fortunate as club cricketers in those days to be able to play against the best.
Yeah.
And one of the most incredible games of cricket I will ever remember was we played a game at Telkom under lights.
Yeah.
Now the Telkom fields had lights that can only be considered as candles.
Okay.
So it was right in the early days of day-night cricket, and it was a club game. And we played against a UPE side. I think it might have been the Pollock side or whatever. Yeah, but they had the likes of Kepler Wessels, Flam Micha.
Yeah.
And as a bowling attack, they had Brett Schultz, Johnson and Feenstra coming at us. And one would have thought, well, Warmer, we're going to be blown away.
Yeah.
But we had Baumeister. We had Bryson. We had Harold Donaghy. We had Chris Ulofser, who could turn a ball on anything.
Yeah.
He really could. We had Dave Emsley, who was probably one of the better captains I ever played with or under. Couldn't hit the ball off the square. So, and was the worst spinner I ever saw in the history of cricket.
Really?
But was a great skipper and was a great leader of our club. And Carl and all the guys that were with us in those days, I mean, Chris Kennedy could hit us to victory in two overs.
Sure.
He a big hitter of a cricket ball. But a lot of people don't realize that Dave Emsley was the first individual to think about unification. Uh-huh. And Warmer was way ahead of its time in the 80s already, long before, in the early 80s, long before the country started unifying cricket.
Yes, yes.
Where we had the United Cricket Club as part of our setup, and Dave orchestrated that.
Okay.
I don't mind saying this. There might be people who might object to this, but Dave Emsley was an incredible asset to EP cricket, South African cricket, and he was harshly dealt with. Mm. And if cricket was really about cricket in this country, the likes of Dave Emsley would still be there leading us. He's not. He's in a wonderful job at the moment, and I know he's very happy. But cricket in this country is not so happy for the loss of a guy like that. And I said I wouldn't get serious again, but I did. I just did.
Yeah.
And that was important to say. He was an asset we lost. We threw away.
These people, they give their lives, really, and so much energy over so many years to something like to a sport or to anything, you know. Then they deserve to get the kudos, you know.
Which he never did.
Yeah.
But anyway, let's move on from
But that. people that know him would know, you know. Yeah. Faye Steinberg said, Uncle Gav, first one to poop 15 rand. We'll see.
Faye is the daughter of Bruce Long, my famous tennis partner.
Oh, right.
And she and my daughter were close when they were still little kids. And we were playing tennis at the club, and we used to get involved after a tennis league match and drink until all hours. And this particular evening, I was given the job of driving the kids home, and Faye was staying at our house that night.
Okay.
And the only reason I got the job was I was the least drunk.
Yes.
So, I mean, I don't know how we got away with that stuff in those days, but we did. But halfway home, out of my tree, I suggested to both my daughter and Faye, and you need to understand that I had one ready.
Oh, right. Yes.
So I knew I was going to win. And I said, first one to fart gets 10 rand, and Faye beat me.
Bugger.
And for years, she's been looking for that 10 rand.
Mark McWilliams says, wow, what a change from the past, 1970.
Your Mark, an old mate of mine from East London, Peter Wolfrey, was one of my principals.
Oh, really?
Way back when I had the agency business.
Best memories at the West Coast
Conference. We won't discuss that.
Okay. Is that
Grant is the head chef at St. Francis at the old Big Time Taverna. He runs the Italian section. Played a lot of hockey with Grant. Great.
We're heading out this weekend. Grant, we'll check you there then.
Garfield Saul's one of the better wicket keepers that played for Old Grey.
Yes.
Great sense of humour.
Oh, excellent.
Full of shit, though.
Yeah. Those clubs and things were so active at that time. I think of the tennis clubs, the cricket clubs, the soccer clubs. You know, it seems to have changed over the years, you know.
Gino, that was my life. And I feel so sorry for the youngsters today.
Yeah.
Because they don't have it.
Yeah.
You know, as a little lighty, I was at clubs for the weekend. I learned very early how to survive on a Coke and a packet of chips.
Yes, that's it.
And that moved on over time to my own sporting career, clubs. It was where I met all my friends. It was where I've met many business colleagues. And
networking.
Without it, I don't know where my life would have been. I mean, clearly, I have a wonderful family. I've got a beautiful wife. I've got great kids. And that would have been great. But me personally, without my friends in the club life, I think it would have been a misery.
Yeah, you're good. You need that. A mate of mine said had an op recently, and he was in hospital, and he was isolated for a bit. But he always claims to be grumpy. He doesn't like all the people around all the time. And even that time for him was like, even a person who's withdrawn, you need to have that contact with people, and real contact, as opposed to a Zoom meeting or a thing.
Yeah.
You know, this part of this show has been to try and connect people in a way that at least you can comment. And you guys can say, how's it online? And we can say, how's it back? You know, try and get that connection back again, you know?
You talk about contact. And I now want to talk about one individual.
Yes.
The poison dwarf.
Who's that?
Robin Adair.
Robin Adair.
Now, I heard rumors that he might be on this evening. And maybe he will be. Okay, but he's probably chicken out. I'm not sure. But Robin Adair... Well, my relationship with Robin Adair can be likened to my attempt one day to get rid of all the moles in my garden.
Yes.
And I'd heard a rumor somewhere that if you put chlorine down the mole hole, and then throw brake fluid on top of that and chuck a brick on top of it.
Sounds like chemicals.
That'll get rid of the moles. Well, again, Blondie will tell you that I blew our entire garden to pieces.
That's like a gimmick.
So my relationship, it's a massive bomb. And I liken that to the relationship that I have with Adair, the midget.
Okay.
Because if you put the two of us in a room together, there's going to be a problem.
Okay.
And there have been many. And the one I'd like to tell you, because there are many.
Yes.
Some of them are probably not.
Yes. We often have that on the show where people can't tell all the stories.
I took my wife to a very romantic dinner, one of the few in 44 years that I have to go on.
Oh, you need to go
to a Greek restaurant.
Oh, nice.
And I spotted her there in a far corner with his missus, and thought it was a clever idea to take one of those Greek plates that they like to throw.
Yes, yes.
That break easily.
Yes.
And I snuck up behind him, and I smashed him over the head with it.
Oh.
So it didn't hurt him, because it breaks easy. Yes, yes. And I thought that was very funny, you know, when he sat down. It was an hour later, as he left, Adair, who knew nothing about Greek plates, had picked up his real plate and smashed me over the head, and I was half unconscious for days.
So, it's a special kind of plate, Robert.
I think Robert. He might have known that, because that's what he's like. He's a shocker. But I love him, and we still play golf together, and there's still drama.
Okay.
There's always drama with that man, but it's fun.
You need those friendships.
Very important.
Over the years, relationships are everything in your life, isn't it? From earliest days, you know, those connections are so valuable as you go through your life.
They are, yes.
When you need people, and you're in the crap.
I don't need Robin Adair though. I move towards him because it's fun. But I actually don't need him in my life, because he causes more drama in my life than it's worth.
Well, put your headphones on, because we've got Chris here, which I think is also another one of those friends.
Kennedy.
So we're going to see if Chris is around. Chris, can you hear us?
Yes, I can hear you. Yeah.
Excellent. I can.
Stoffel. Hey, boy.
You're naughty.
So, Chris.
You've been far too serious, Gavin. We're going to have to bring up some of these old ones here.
I want to hear any stories that you've got, Chris. How long have you known this man?
I know Gavin from the early 80s. I was looking back now the other day, and it's now like 40 years. Can you believe it, Gavin? We've heard and experienced hundreds of stories over our time. I tell you, I don't think I've laughed more with a person than I have with you over those days. In many ways, I'm Gavin's external memory drive, because some of the stories that he told me in the 80s, I remember, and he's forgotten. So, Gavin, I'm going to kick off a couple of stories for you, and I want you to remember them and tell the story. But the one that's, there are quite a few that stick out for me, but the one about the elderly French woman that brought her toy boy onto the island at Mauritius. Please share that story, Gavin.
Okay. Tell us that story. What's going on?
This thing's echoing.
You got an echo in there? Okay. I'll see what's going on here with this. But you can tell us, can you hear this?
Do you want me to tell it now?
Yes, that story. Yes, please.
Zell and I took the kids to Mauritius years ago, as Chris would suggest.
Yes.
And while we were there, we were lying on the beach the one day, and some local walked up to us and suggested we buy a ticket for a beach party at another island.
Okay.
So we bought a ticket. Well, we bought tickets for the whole family, and we were going to go to this beach party. And he ended up with four or five of these boats that took about 14 people each. And I remember saying to Azel, yeah, this looks like it could be a decent party, but a lot of these people don't look like they know how to have a party. Yeah. So I said to the guy who owned the place, because we were on, he owned the whole story. He was on our boat, and I said to him, listen, my friend, all these oaks have a proper party. He said, some of them maybe not so much. He said, but I will tell you that I targeted you because I heard you were South African. And it's always important to have some South Africans on a beach party. Because then it's fun.
Yes, of course.
So I said, and if the whole lot's South Africans, he says, no, then I lose money. Because you will notice that the drinks are all part of the deal.
Yes.
So you drink as much as you like.
Yes.
Eat and drink. So he said, never have five boatloads of South Africans, but always have a few.
Okay, so I said, no, that's great. Drink too much. Yes.
But when we got on the beach, the one thing that I did notice was there was a scantily clad French chick of about 50.
Yes, okay.
But with her was this 21-year-old Swede who was clearly in Mauritius for activities other than just beach parties.
Oh, right, yes.
Anyway, she decided.
Shirley Valentine.
She decided that she was going to go tan naked around the corner, and I remember Azel grabbing me and saying, "Well, you don't need to see anything over there. Yes. You just stay here." And we had this lovely party, and I got this youngster involved in this party. And while I was drinking beer, I was giving him this Mauritian rum.
Rum, yes, I have.
And
that.
He drank a lot of it, and I was encouraging that the whole time until eventually he passed out on the beach.
Oh, dear.
And then I lost interest in him for a while. I forgot about him for a bit, which was a bit naughty. But anyway, I went back to the party, and we were having a lot of fun. And it was only when this French chick came back and saw this lighty lying on the beach, he was now red like a lobster.
Oh, dear. Oh, sure, he'd been tanning a bit.
He was woken up, water was thrown on him, he was woken up, and we all went back with, there were a few sad faces, not ours, we were still having a lot of fun. But it was the next morning that was the greatest, when that French chick walked into the breakfast room, and the Hogg family were sitting there minding their own business, and she walked past and nearly spat on me.
Oh my word.
Followed 10 minutes later by this lighty, who could barely walk.
Oh no.
He was blistered from head to toe.
Oh, shame.
Anyway, I was never allowed to see that youngster again.
I'm sure.
Because clearly his services were ended on one beach party.
I'm sure. Oh, magic. Gary, can you take the mics out of this one? It's just giving him an echo.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Okay, so no, I think the echo's gone now. So
yeah, that's the story.
You have to hear what Chris is saying there. So, yeah, Chris, yeah. I love that.
So the good Catholic boy from De La Salle. I remember you telling us stories about being an altar boy on the altar with
your really?
Brother, and something happened with the nose and your old man, and he fell out of the bench or something. Can you tell us that one, Chicken?
Yeah, that was that was the day my dad was doing the reading.
Yes.
In mass.
Good Catholic boy.
On the one Sunday. My brother, who's 10 years younger than me, had just started as an altar boy, and I'd finished with that stuff. I wasn't doing that stuff anymore.
Yes.
But my dad and my mom had said to me, listen, it's Neil's first time. Won't you do the duties with him? And
altar boy stuff.
I really, Anyway, yeah, I'll do it.
Yes.
So there we were. My dad did the reading, yeah, and then went and sat in an area where the congregation couldn't see him.
Yeah.
But we were sitting, Neil on the left-hand side facing the congregation, yeah, the priest, yeah, and myself, and there was what the priest called a moment of silent prayer.
Yes.
And we all bowed our heads, yes, and my brother sneezed. And this long McGafter,
oh no,
jumped out of his nose.
Oh, no.
And all I saw was, oh, no, Neil doing this. So I took a hanky out my pocket because I knew he didn't have one.
Yeah.
And I threw it past the priest. Neil managed to clean up, but when I looked up, my father was lying on the bench, his legs in the air, screaming with laughter. The entire congregation had fallen over, but it was my father lying on the bench with his legs in the air that did it for me, and we all got the giggles.
Yes.
And all the priest had to offer was, you cannot take this hog family anyway.
Oh, I love it.
So on the subject of De La Salle, tell us what you and Roy Devan did at the Queen's College reunion when you sang the sang your whole creed or whatever it's called.
Roy Devan's watching this. He's going to kill me for this. Roy Devan of the famous Sir Roy's B&Bs.
Oh, yes, yes, yes. Okay.
Wonderful man. Very good friend of mine. Mm-hmm. But we had a golf tournament at Humid going for a while, and I don't know why it stopped, but yeah, at one stage it was a team of 16 guys from UCT, yep, ex-UCT guys, Rhodes, UPE, yes, and I think Stellenbosch. And then they said to me, well, why don't you captain a side of barbarians? I said, well, why barbarians? I said, well, Oaks who could never make it to varsity.
Yes.
So, okay, so we did. So you picture the scene. There's five sides, yeah, of 16.
Yeah.
Can I take this?
Yeah, yeah, you can. Yeah.
Five sides of 16. That's a lot of guys already. Yeah, but yeah, then yeah, all their partners and friends and that arrive at Humid, yeah, afterwards. And so there's a lot of people in the club at Humid. Yeah. It's great fun.
Yeah.
And I always loved school rugby and, yeah, school war cries.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. War cries.
Anyway, right. Suddenly we were renditioned with the Queen's boys had got together in a corner and they sang the Queen's war cry.
Okay. Nice.
I thought, yeah, that's fantastic. Do something. Then the Selborne boys got together.
He's having a laugh, obviously.
And then the Selborne boys got together and they did their thing. And I'm looking around, and De La Salle wasn't a big school. I mean, yeah, for a start, we probably had 11 rugby players in the whole school.
Okay.
And that was from 1960 to 1980. But I found one.
Yeah.
The world famous Roy Devan, yeah, who had been at De La Salle a couple of years before me, but he was a De La Salle man. And I went to him, I said, Roy boy, we can't leave it like this.
Yeah.
He said, Hog, there are hundreds of people here. There are two of us. How are we going to sing a war cry?
Yeah.
I said, Devan, we are going to sing a war cry. He said, but there's another problem. I said, what's that? He said, I've forgotten the war cry. So I reminded him, I said, my bad.
Yeah.
Izapa!
Yeah.
I know he remembers.
Okay.
So now I jump up and I get everybody's attention, make a lot of noise, keep everybody quiet. Yes. De La Salle are now going to sing.
Yes. It's your chance.
Are you ready, Roy boy?
It's the big one.
Ready? And we went, Izapa! And his teeth jumped up. And that was me, lying on the ground, Roy diving for his teeth. No, it was Roy's going to kill me for that. Okay.
It was a big pee.
There's a Gerald Walter there. Right, nice shirt, Gina.
Yeah, thank you, Gerald. Thank
you're
you,
up Gerald. Next, Gerald.
Yes, Gerald's going to, we're definitely going to have Gerald on at some stage as well.
Yeah, I don't want to hog my moment here, excuse the pun.
Yeah, excuse but, the pun, yes.
I have to slip, or you have to slip two warmer stories in and then I'm done. Okay, Gavin, the warmer one when we had a big golf day and Bobby Giles was the organizer and the guys went to Bobby Giles' house to fetch the prizes. You don't recall it. You probably don't recall that. And when Bobby Giles came off the course, all these Lani prizes were on the stage, but in amongst the prizes was Bobby Giles' lounge suite, which the guys had bought.
I don't remember that, no.
To close off my question, Gav, tell them how you, sort of how it came to be the end at Warmer. What barman you met when you went in the last time at Warmer when you went upstairs? You knew that woman was used to get sad, but it's actually very funny as well.
thanks, Chris. Okay, we're going to say goodbye to Chris.
Chris, shut up. Thank you. No, that is a very funny story, but it's also very sad because Warmer Country Club was one of the most incredible clubs you can imagine. It had every
upstairs, I remember.
But besides that, it was archery, it was rugby, squash. It was squash, it was hockey, it was tennis, it was golf, bowls, the works.
Proper country cricket, club, cricket, I suppose.
It was a proper country club, and you could really go there and, as a family, have a lot of fun and whatever. And as things got closer and closer to where we are these days. Mm-hmm. The first thing that happened was I remember arriving for a game of cricket and our covers had been stolen. But we knew that before we got to the ground because the covers were now the roof of one of the houses at Rumor Township.
Seen it.
So we reported that and we were asked, well, what do you want us to do? It's his roof. I said, well, it was our covers. But anyway, the second thing that happened was we were in the middle of a Premier League game of cricket and the side screens fell over because they'd stolen the supports for a braai or for a fire. And then the Gordon Crooks or Charles Crooks, I can't remember, the whole tea booth went missing one Friday night. And we arrived on Saturday and the entire tea booth was gone. And then bits of the change room started going missing.
Yes.
And I remember my last game, which is the one Chris was talking about, was I was always last out the change room.
Yeah.
Always had a few beers in the change room first, and then we went up to the club. And I did the walk up to the clubhouse, and the entire side and the opposition were already in the pub, which was the upstairs bar.
Pub, yes.
And I walked up the first section of the stairs, and as I turned to go up the second flight, four goats attacked me. They were coming out the pub.
Goats.
I remember just standing to one side, letting four goats go out, and I walked into the pub, and I said, "Boys, we are finished."
Oh, man.
Was, in fact, the end of Warmer Cricket Club.
Really,
it wasn't the end of the country club, but it was the end of the cricket club.
Yeah.
It was that day we decided to call it quits.
Because I don't know what's happening. There's some development going on there, but we hope that the other clubs will take up the lead, you know. I see 10th Avenue Tennis Club there, Warmer 10th, been going for like 100.
Yeah, Viv Jacobs, who was on there earlier, she's very much part of that club.
She's still there because
I don't know if she's still there, but she was a stalwart member.
I was a member then. She was for many years as well. Talking legend, talking to legend. Thanks, Kevin. Come on, Warmer. Yes. We've got a little Warmer now as well, which is really looking beautiful too. I'm a member there for the running club, Achilles. Yeah. Achilles running club. We run there.
You run out of Warmer Golf Club. They've done a lot to improve that whole setup there. It's beautiful. Beautiful to have.
Very nice. I'm having a game with Mike Profferman tomorrow. In fact, a little game of golf.
Belfers?
Yes. Well, there we go. I see he's running again. I'm glad to see Profferman's running again. That's good. Wayne Murray says, had an awesome year, 96 playing for Warmer. Eh? 96, that's a while ago, Wayne Murray. I hope he's still playing. And I see Peter Wolfrey saying, Gav, just how much pink salt did Emma add to his pilchers on the Saldana pilchard?
I used to do Saldana pilchers for them when I was an agent. But Neil Minar there, I see, he's just jumped up there.
Yes, I won't ask what the pilchard is about, because that doesn't look great.
No, okay. We're moving along briskly.
Yes, moving on briskly from that.
Did you find Neil Minar there? Because that was
there we go. Yes, who was the best cricket player, cricket captain he played under, and what was the best knockout punch he ever threw in a pub? I sense that Neil knows already.
You see, Minar was one of my cricket captains during my lengthy cricket career.
Yes, I think he was talking about Emsley. You know?
No. In actual fact, for Emsley's benefit, Neil's benefit, and everybody else who ever captained me on a cricket field, it was actually Dudley Tricker. So hard luck, boys.
Oh, Dudley.
But the best knockout punch, I know what he's referring to. It was in the old Johnny's bar in Johannesburg. I was playing at Johnny's, and Neil was my captain. But Neil was the first guy to introduce pre-season practices and a lot of fitness bullshit.
Of course, really. Why do you need to be fit to play sport?
And in those days, I was fit enough, in my opinion. And anyway, he had us running all over the place. But this one particular Saturday, just before the season started, he called a pre-season practice, which we did in the morning.
Yeah.
And then that was followed by Brian and a big piss up in the pub afterwards. And Johnny's pub was really conducive to a proper party.
Bit of a fight as well, maybe.
Anyway, yeah.
I sense something is coming here.
It was late in the afternoon,
right,
and we were all well overcupped.
Yes.
And Blondie, because all our wives and girlfriends had joined us, and Blondie had joined us, and she was drinking Olsen in the day and probably had overcupped as well.
Okay.
She came across to where I was talking to a few boys and said, Craig McDougall. Now, Craig McDougall was 7 foot.
Okay.
He was an opening bowler. He was
Scottish.
He was a monster. Very nice guy, by the way, but he was a monster.
Yeah.
And she said, and I hope I can do this, but she said, Craig McDougall's just told me to fuck off. So I said, I beg your pardon?
It's that Scottish, you know.
I said, I beg your pardon? Why? She said, I don't know, he just picked on me. So I went to Craig. Now, you must understand that Craig was sitting on a bar stool like this, and I was standing in front of him. He was still taller than me.
Yes.
And I said, Craig, what did you say to my missus? And he told me.
Yes.
And I said, well, my bud, that's not going to work for me.
Yes.
And you should stop that. Otherwise, you and I are going to have a problem. Now, that'll give you a clear indication of how much I've been drinking.
Yes, sir.
Because I shouldn't have been saying any of this.
McDougall is Scottish and he's going to say, oh, roll it.
The problem was that while Craig was a wonderful guy and he was never going to punch me, his little mate, Dave Rawlings, ex-SA schools cricketer, by the way, was standing next to him. And Dave and I were never great mates.
Yeah.
Be that as it may, he was one of our teammates.
Yes.
He decided this was a good opportunity to pin me. And he did. He clipped me while I was looking at McDougall. And my Scottish blood jumped out.
Yes,
and I turned and climbed into David. But unfortunately, when I turned, Blondie had put up a ringside seat.
Yes.
And she was sitting watching, and my elbow connected Blondie, and she was the only one knocked out that night.
I know. He knocked out your own wife. You know.
And the end of that story was McDougall stood up, and he picked both of us up off our feet and held us, and then bashed our heads together and said, now look what you've done.
Now look what you've done to Blondie. I told her to fuck off. Now you've done that.
True story. True story.
She didn't have a good night. Russ Timothy saying, I was at the cricket. Well,
yeah, good hockey mate of mine.
Greatest storyteller. Well, we're happy to get some more of those. Spencer, special kind of friendship.
Barbara, very Barbara. Special lady.
But Barbara has done an amazing job. Let me just say, an opportunity as well to thank Barbara for what she's done for the show as well.
Yeah.
She's been fantastic. We've got a little a group of guys that have been helping with the guests as well to get people in, and for various people. And Barbara's been one of them. Thank you so much, Bobs. We really appreciate it. Appreciate that. Dave, put away.
There was a little chirp there from David about Bobby Rogers.
Booby Rogers.
Bobby. Booby Rogers. That was another warmer cricket side. That was the bottom side, the fourth leaguers who called a Stadler captain for a while. The world famous called a Stadler.
Yes, he's a comedian as well. A
very funny man.
Yes.
But he captained that side, and they used to pick 10 guys every week, and then they used to just make sure Bobby arrived as the 11th. Now, Bobby was one of the most enthusiastic sportsmen I ever knew. He was a great friend of mine, but Bobby's ball skills in those days were negligible.
So fifth team.
Yeah, but
okay.
A fun guy to have around.
Yes.
Always.
Yes.
So he was always picked first, and then they picked the other 10.
Okay.
But Bobby went through a cricket season where he played 8 matches. Yeah. He scored 7 ducks in a row.
So that's a world record, Bobby.
No. It doesn't end there. In his 8th and last match,
yes,
they gave him an opportunity to go and resurrect himself, and they let him open.
Oh.
But the guy who was bowling was particularly quick
and
wild and woolly.
But not Mark van Vuuren.
Bobby was trying to avoid any ball that was bowled him at the time, and managed to run to square leg quite often. but eventually managed to get a nick down to third man, and he set off for a run, and the entire Warmer Cricket Club was cheering because Bobby was about to get his first run. He got run out coming back for two.
No! Bobby, you should have stopped at one, man. You just got too greedy.
There are more sports stories about Bob, but leave it out.
I'm sure.
His squash career was even worse.
Oh, dear. Oh dear. Lee Sharps, there you go.
Lee Wild, another great friend of my wife's.
The wild gooses, is that what they call it?
Yeah, no, that's her husband. He liked to let the wild goose go every now and again.
Stapes, I just mentioned you now. I hope you're doing well. How are your lips, buddy? I saw that their lips were big. They said, I don't know, what did you eat? Did you eat shellfish or something? Tracy Walter saying, when is your ticket to
Mombasa? That's the same question that Mike Van Furen, Fires Van Furen, is asking.
Yes.
He even phoned me last night to ask me to tell that story, but I don't think that's going to happen.
It's not appropriate.
It doesn't need to be toned down.
Oh, okay.
Might be politically incorrect.
Oh, right. Well, you never know. People see things online and they cut it out and they put it into take it out of context. Keith Clark, we got you. We got a bit of punters for you, Keith. Lekker, man. Very nice, eh?
Can I see you, biscuit, my boy?
Yeah, it's been good. We
are running out of soda.
There we go. My wife's online saying Gavin always supports our Elton Academy golf day. Thank you for that.
More importantly, Philippa, what you people do for that school is amazing. So it's a privilege to be part of it.
They do. It's 24/7. It never stops.
It's a privilege to be amazing. Part of it. You and Mark and the rest of the team. Unbelievable.
For sure. Ronald Minar actually wakes up every morning at 6 o'clock or half past 5 to come and say how's it, because he's in New Zealand. So he wakes up there. John D says, you're a beautiful man. Gavin, David, thanks for sharing the passion and the fun. Don't forget.
Oh, God.
Duckworth comes from Zimbabwe.
No. That is a very beautiful story. That was when Ducky first... I mean, he's now head of Cerebos sales.
Okay.
So he's come a long way from the day that John's talking about.
Wow. Okay.
It was the day that I pulled Ducky out of my agency business and pulled him into Cerebos.
Yes.
Brand new, green behind the ears.
Yeah.
And we were summoned to a meeting in Joburg. We'd just been bought out by another group prior to the Bud group. We'd just been bought out and we were now about to meet the new chairman. So it was John, myself and Ducky, but we'd gone up, Ducky and I had gone up to do other customer business and whatever, and we'd arranged to meet John at this restaurant, and then the new chairman was going to meet us.
Okay, got to put good impressions.
Anyway, but we had a bit of a time to wait before we went to the restaurant, and Ducky and I had a few beers at the hotel.
Okay.
And at one point I said to Ducky, Duck balls, slowly, we've got a big night ahead of us still. Anyway, we'd had enough.
Yes.
And we went to this restaurant. We met John and everything was fine.
Yeah.
And then the chairman arrived.
Okay.
We sat down and he quizzed me a lot. And
okay.
The sales director, boof, boof, boof. And wah, wah, wah. Yes. And Ducky slipped into a bit of a false sense of security because everything was being fired at me.
Yes, you, yeah.
And he was nice and relaxed. And suddenly... he turned around to Ducky, and what he meant when he said, so where do you come from? What he meant by that was, so how do you fit in? Because no one had told the chairman that Ducky had just been brought in.
Yes.
So he said, so where do you come from? And Ducky said, I am from Zimbabwe. John and myself collapsed in a heap. The chairman was left like... the MD and the sales director are laughing. Duckworth is red in the face. And he was saying, boys, you've got to share this.
What are you talking about? Oh, no. Okay, it looks like we've got to have earphones on again because we're coming. I want to go into a little bit of your history.
You find some soda.
I can use some more soda here as well.
Oh, there we go.
And a bit of ice is
probably no, don't worry about
left that. As well. And there's some whiskey there too. But we're going to bring on somebody. I'm not sure who's coming on next. Who we got? Is it David? David, can
yes,
you hear us, Dave? How's it?
Right, and you?
Lovely, man. Good to have you on.
Thank you for having me. Hello, Groggy.
You know, hey, Darby.
Hey,
good, thank you.
David's obviously still couldn't convince us that he's very sporty with his Adidas stuff there. Martin Neft would have been pleased to see that the other day. He was on.
well, Gavin will know, and the story I'm going to tell you is actually about laughter, because you know this man can laugh, and he got me laughing one weekend, but I'm gonna build up to that. But yes, I met Gavin obviously on the sporting field, and you'll know it wasn't in the first division cricket. My days cricket was spent as a cake league player at Queen's College. But in 1995, I joined the Buccaneers Pirates, and I think it's almost 27 years we've been playing hockey every year since. And I think Gavin will probably back me up here. I was brought on to bolster the defense of the Buccaneers, and I think you've never looked back, Gavin. I think I've fulfilled the job.
We've been looking back, us forwards have been looking back ever since you got there, bud.
You know, there's a big rivalry, obviously, with the strikers and the defenders.
We think they think we,
and so forth. So that's ongoing.
But anyway, that's hockey now.
I will tell you, it's hockey, but I will tell you that we can never score enough goals to beat what they let in.
Oh, really? It's a hard ask. It's a tough ask.
Gavin will tell you that I am a sweeper, so I am the last line of defense. And even as far away from me as he is, he regularly hears two words when they are attacking me and running past me. All he hears is, oh shit. as we scramble to get back to defend.
And I love hearing that. Those are my best moments on a Sunday, is listening to excellent. That rubbish.
So it's a Sunday thing, eh? You guys have good times.
In season, every Sunday. I think every year we've played hockey except in 2020. But yes, my story actually, Gino, is about a golf trip.
Okay.
And just to give you a little background, and I know the tour director and the tour fines chairman are looking, so I won't go into any details about what they're doing the tour. But this particular year, I'm part of a group of 12 guys, and I'm very lucky to be involved with them, and they're really good mates, and Gavin's one of the stall leaders of the whole pack. This particular year, we went to Grahamstown. Now, just to give you a little bit of insight, we go to play good golf, and all you want is to be the winner on the day and the winner at the end of the tour. It's about good golf.
Yes.
But in between that, there are many other awards, and they involve misdemeanors that may take place. Yes. And I'd like to suggest that Gavin is actually one of the better golfers, more consistent golfers on every tour. Uh-huh. But on his mantelpiece, there are more awards that are belong to the misdemeanor side than the golf side. And he knows, but we won't go there.
Is it filled up his mantelpiece?
You know, on this particular weekend, we ended up in Grahamstown. We normally go down to the Wild Coast. And that was a new course.
The Wild Coast. We've never been to the Wild Coast ever.
Oh, it was not so far down.
Kevin, what's the difference?
Garden Route. The other way. Yeah, the other way is where you find the Wild Coast, where you find that stuff. David.
Anyway, sorry to interrupt, David. I just wanted to go in the right direction.
Yeah. Garden Route.
Grahamstown was on the way to the Garden Route. That was what I meant.
Okay, I see. Okay.
Anyway, we played golf. It was a wonderful day, and thereafter we had our traditional fines meeting. And Gavin nor myself got any awards for leaders on that particular day, but Gavin was the recipient of one of his awards, which is for some misdemeanor. Yeah. But anyway, after that, we all laughed, we all joked. We had a few drinks, then we got back into the car to go back to Grahamstown. I ended up in the car with Gavin. And as we took off, we rehashed what happened in that fines meeting when he received this award, which was in the form of a shirt. Okay. But we suddenly got the giggles, and we started laughing. And Gavin will know, when we bring the story up, we laugh like we cannot believe. It started in the car, and it didn't stop until we got to our destination. We went to a pub, and the guys must have thought we were behaving like kids. They tried to separate us. I eventually went and sat on the other end of the bar, trying to avoid contact with Gavin. But sometimes I just see what he's doing, and we back out laughing. We just had that luck sector that we couldn't get rid of.
Yes. Oh, I love it.
I can never forget. I even know why we were laughing, by the way.
No.
Gavin Loon, in fact, was the reason.
Gavin
was what started it. Yeah.
Oh, really?
You know, we all know that Gav Loon is one of the snappiest dressers on the planet.
Yes,
slides uphill, he does.
No, he knows his fashion sense.
And Gav was one of the recipients of the bad shirts that night.
See.
So he had to take this beautiful, brand new shirt.
Give it off, to you.
And now he put it on a chair.
Oh, right.
And I was already in my punishment shirt.
Yes.
He got one as well.
Okay.
And he put this punishment shirt on, but we'd been drying already.
Yeah.
And there were no serviettes.
So you used
and I picked up his fancy shirt. I've got video evidence of that, which I think David took.
Gavin's watching there tonight. No,
and Loon nearly had a heart attack. So that's what got us going.
Classic David.
Yeah, that continued for the whole weekend, and we even shared a room. And I think at 3 a.m, one of us would wake up, we'd have a little giggle, we'd get the other one going, and it just never stopped. You know, Gavin can laugh, but
no, you know,
a wonderful weekend.
It's a laugh is, I always say a laugh is better when you're really tired as well, when you're really buggered, you've had a long day. And then your brain is tired, but you start laughing and you can't stop.
Or when you're not supposed to.
Yeah. When you're not supposed
to. Or you're
not
allowed.
Oh, damn, Jason.
You know, thank you. Yes, there are many more stories, but that's the one I picked on.
Yes. No, thank
Shut
you. Shut
Darby.
Dave.
Love you lots, my brother.
Thanks for coming on.
Thank you.
Check Gav Loon's there now, I'm sure.
No, he's there. I see he's around. And
I don't know how much time we got left, but there is one individual we still got to talk about, remember?
Oh, no, okay. No, we'll
the world famous cricketer still got to jump out to.
Keith Clark says, Neil Minnar, a good old pal at good times in his Cape Town day. So, excellent. And Viv, Jake says what a legend you are, Gab. He said,
Gab.
She's had a few. Have you had a few drinks?
And Bob White, another neighbour of mine, White. Lovely man.
There's Gab saying, "How's it, Gavin Lewis?"
Yeah, it is.
Was it like skipping?
Yeah.
Philip Krieger. Now there's a name that we.
Can I take this off?
I
because
think, you know what you do. You put one. You can put one on if you want to. I think it's time to probably bring. Okay, let's have a story about
Krieger.
Yes.
No, but I can go on for a long time about this.
No, it's fine. It's fine. We'll warm him up.
No, Gav Loon has set the scene by saying, "What was it like to captain Philip Krieger on a cricket field?"
Yes,
it was very messy. He's a wonderful friend of mine.
Yes.
One of the guys, as I said to you before the show even started, that reinvented himself. I'm very proud of him and grateful to be his mate. But he's also one of the guys that I seek out whenever it's time for fun.
Okay.
If it's time for fun and you need people to make you laugh, find Krieger and that's what will happen. But on the cricket field, it was slightly different because while in the pub, I love nothing better than laughing and talking shit.
Yeah.
On the cricket field, it's time to be serious.
All right. Okay.
And we play the game properly and we win the game and then we go in the pub and we have fun.
All right.
Krieger was one of the individuals that, well, firstly, he was the worst batsman in the history of cricket.
Oh, okay.
But he was a great bowler, so he could win games for us.
All right.
And he did often. Win games for us as a bowler.
But he's number 11. He's like not going to say.
He's definitely number 11.
Okay. In fact, there he is. Put on your headphones. See, we decided we needed some fun, so we brought in Philip Krieger all the way from the farm.
This is a clown, this. This is a proper clown. He belongs in your industry.
Philip, lovely to have you on. Lovely.
Cheers. Thanks for having me here.
Then look at this, Craig Buttergill saying that you should have Philip Krieger on the show with you.
Exactly.
Who's Craig?
Exactly like that.
No, I belong here, like on the farm, just quiet and innocent.
Philip, it's good to, I believe you're on Ostrich Farm there?
Absolutely, yes. I'm waiting for a truck to come collect birds just now.
Brilliant, brilliant. And I was having a chat. I was having a chat with Gav, and he's saying that you really took that farm from nothing, and it's creating some good business now.
Well, we're trying, eh? We're trying that. Anyway.
No, yeah. he's too modest.
He's too modest.
But he really has done well there, and I'm not scared to say that.
Lovely. So, Philip, yes.
Well, I just want to. Some of the oaks alluded earlier. I saw fires yes. every time. I couldn't wait for Saturday to get to the field where I could get okay. under Gavin Hogg's skin and Robin the Bears. I should count the sleeps down before Saturday arrived because I knew that I'm going to piss Gavin Hogg off today somehow, and I've got to work a way out. You know, and that was my mission. It wasn't about. Cricket really, but it was to see him yes. go red in the face. we had fines meetings after a game, and there were awards, five awards we handed out, and one of those awards was Johnny Jism, which means you go for the most voyager miles per over. And I was a bowler, yeah. and I made sure that I'm not going to get that. And he was also a bowler too. So the one day. I mean, we'd smashed everybody, and Gavin was bowling, couldn't get the ball off. The batsman couldn't get the ball off the square, and I was standing on the field.
Yeah.
And you can carry on with that story, and where I found the Lipos bomb there, you know.
Tell me the story.
Yeah, of course I can. that story.
Yeah.
Cricket used to get bored in the cricket field a lot.
Yeah.
Because I used to field him in what he calls periwinkle places. Because, in fact, I'm going to move away from that story just quickly to paint the picture.
Yes, okay.
At Aberdare once.
Yes.
I was in the slips with Robin Adair and Tufty Warner and I think Zach Long, Bruce's son, was at wicketkeeper.
Yes.
And one of the oaks had been dropped from the top side was steaming in. Vicious, trying to get his place back.
All right, yes.
And suddenly the umpire's arm went out and stopped him halfway through his run, and there was chaos. And,
okay.
And the umpire said, "Captain." So I walked up to this umpire and I said, "Yeah, what's wrong?" He said, "Please take control of your players." I said, "Well, what are you talking about?" He says, "Have a look at your third man." I turned and Philip Krieger had pulled massive logs onto the field, and it started a bonfire on the cricket field.
Philip, what the hell?
I walked down to third man and asked Philip what he thought he was doing, and he said, "It's your fault, Hogg." And I said, "How is this bonfire on a cricket field my fault?" He said, "It's because you filled me in periwinkle places." I said, "What do you want to do?" He said, "I want to field at point."
Yeah.
So I said, "Well, so we all had to move the fire off the field." I then moved him to point. Two balls later, someone cut the ball at him.
Yeah.
And the first thing he did was,
you know.
So he went straight back to third man.
Afterwards, back to third man.
So, but the story Philip's talking about now.
Yes.
Is he was bored because he was put in a place where I didn't want him fielding
yes.
in an important place. And he was bored again, and he found this tube of lip ice. And he picked it up, he looked inside, and he said he was quite surprised to see that it wasn't a white color substance in the lip ice jar. It was brown.
Okay.
So he sniffed it.
Yeah.
And it was what he refers to as dog ass.
Oh, right.
So it was dog poop in this. But now, a normal person would have thrown that lip ice long away.
Yes,
he put it in his pocket.
Of course, for later use.
And brought it to fines meeting. So Philip was one of the, along with Louis de Toy, another good friend of ours, the greatest fines masters I've ever had the pleasure of doing fines with. But Philip was a very good fines master, and he started the meeting off by getting the barman to pour a glass of liquor that had a lot of stuff in it. So whoever was going to drink that was going to fall over.
Yes.
And his speech started off with, "What we're going to do now is And he explained what was in this tube of lip ice.
Yeah.
He said, we're going to send this around. And everybody's got to sniff it.
Yes.
First person to puke's got to drink. First person to puke's got to drink this drink. And I put my hand up and reminded Philip that Midget, Adair and Hogg were old enough to say, we're not involved in this.
Yes.
And don't even try get us involved. So he changed his tack a little bit. He said, okay, what we'll do is we'll go from the youngest to the oldest. And Hogg, being the oldest, is going to get it last.
Okay.
And he started off with a guy by the name of Chris Misplan.
Yeah.
And Chris, a nice lighty. Chris didn't play around.
Yeah.
He sniffed properly.
Okay.
He sniffed in big time.
Yeah.
And the first person to puke was Philip Kricker.
Ah, no!
You could smell what he was smelling.
Ah, no! What did he say? You puked in a... What do you call
it? I saw his face and I re-smelt it again.
Are you the kind of guy that has pregnancy pains when your wife's giving birth as well?
So I can't believe these stories have got to this level.
It's an empathy puke.
Well, one of the other things is, like, I couldn't wait to get cricket, and I probably heard the story, I don't know how many times, from Gavin Hogg, and I see Firestone Fearon mentioned it, Elvin Rees mentioned it, and it was about Hogg telling a story about a guy trying to buy a ticket to Mombasa. I mean,
you see.
Like, on the side of the field a couple of times. I'd love to hear that story.
Okay, before we get to that story, because maybe I will tell it, but I want him to tell the story about the day he and I got a late call up for the top side.
Oh.
We got a call late on a Friday. And the one thing that was always important to me, never be late.
Yeah, okay.
But with Keith Reed, Pops Reed, as coach of that top side,
okay,
you were never late.
Okay.
You always got there in time for practice. Let him tell that
story. Tell us, Philip, what happened there?
So we were in the pub at Old Grey. We had a bar the next day. And so we're having a few drinks. And the next thing, two guys pulled out from the side, the top side. So they asked Gavin and I, under the weather, you guys like to play tomorrow? Well, yeah, for sure, we'll play.
Of course we'll play.
We're not having a party. We just pull it in us. The next morning, we woke up. I remember, damn it, I've got a cricket match. I'm playing at Heatherbank. I wake up at literally 10 to 9. I speed off to Heatherbank. I pull in there at 20 past 9. As I'm driving in there, I see all the guys are zigzagging and throwing balls around. I run with my kit, put it down in the changing room, and Hogg's not there. And I'm going, yes! Hogg's not there because I'm not the only one in trouble. Pops is throwing balls around, and now watch what's going on here. They've got a wicket here, and the Oaks are zigzagging and doing things. I get behind a long queue. Carlo Giacconi's in front of me, and I said, and there comes this Mercedes-Benz screaming in there. I said, Jake, Hogg's come now. Watch this. He's going on. He gets out the car, he runs. But now he hasn't had time to see what the pattern is. So he's got right to the end of the queue. He has no choice. The ball comes to him. He just picks it up and he just throws it. And he head off. Okay. And that's the moment he threw his glove on the ground and said, this is absolute chaos. And that was the end of the warm-up practice.
The warm-up.
We sat in the changing room there.
He forgets that the first thing I said, to Philip was, what must I do?
What must I do? What must I do? I don't know.
It was chaos. It's a bad screen.
You know, the first team, they do much more warm-ups and that sort of
thing. Yeah, our side never did that stuff.
Much more professional, Philip. That's the one.
Anyway, the story that him and Fires are going on and on about.
Yes.
Was the... Philip, I'm going to take this off so I can't hear you.
Yeah.
But it was the story of when the Zimbabwe railways put together a new ticketing system.
Okay.
And they computerized their ticketing system. Yes. You see. So on this particular day, this guy arrives at the ticket office and he says, I want a ticket for Mombasa.
Okay.
And the guy sitting at this computer says, we have got a new system here. When I punch on this system, later on, your ticket gonna jump out, just like that.
Okay.
I want a ticket for Mombasa, okay? M-O-M-B-A-Z-A, enter.
Yeah.
He said, you want a bedding? He said, no, don't worry about the bedding. We've got the blankets. We've got the sleeping bags. Okay. No bedding, enter. He said, you want a meal ticket? He said, no, we've got the nachos, we've got the bananas, no meal ticket needed. No meal ticket, enter. He said, sir, watch this now. I'm going to push F2. Your ticket is going to jump out. F2 on the screen, error.
Oh, dear.
Oh. Let us start again. Good morning. Good morning.
Oh, dear. Okay.
I want a ticket for Mombasa. M-O-M-B-A-Z-A, enter. He said, bedding? No, I told you. We've got the blankets. We've got a sleeping bag. No bedding. Enter. Meal ticket? Okay, maybe, because you've eaten the nachos and the bananas while you were messing around.
Yeah.
You want a no, don't worry about the meal ticket. No meal ticket.
Okay.
Enter. F2. Error. Jesus. Where is this Mombasa? He said he's waiting in the car for his ticket.
Oh dear. Oh, classic.
It's done now.
Philip, man, well done on the ostriches. We lots of support for you guys here as well. That's an amazing story as well. I'd love to hear that sometime. Because ostriches, like when we spoke a little bit earlier as well about ostriches, those little chicks, anything can go wrong with those ostriches.
Let me tell you a story about that. When he first started, first week of his first clump of baby chicks or whatever they call, he lost about 20% of them.
Good Lord.
In one, so he phoned me and he said, we're in big trouble here.
Yeah.
But at that time, he was getting X amount per kg at the time when they're big and he sends them back.
All right, okay.
Yeah, phoned me a week later. He says, Hog. Now, I'm not involved in this whole story of his, but he says, Hog, our birds have come alive again. I said, what do you mean? He says, I've done another deal with another guy who's going to give us more per kg.
Oh,
so
right.
I said, why didn't you just tell me that? He says, no, our birds came alive.
Okay, came alive. So it's much better like that.
He's done well. Great friend.
No, Philip, that's fantastic. I got to know you through the medical aid side.
Yeah, back in the day of med scheme.
Yes. A med scheme, and then also, I think, eminent child days at Toby Joe's, probably.
That's right. And I've got a story as well about
Hog
invited me to a bra waste,
God, yes. No.
Yeah.
So it goes back. So I've always teased Gavin, he always used to bring his family to watch cricket, and his Blondie would be there, and Taryn would be there. Taryn was only little at the time, and then years went by, and now suddenly Taryn's a big lady. And she's 25, and I've been teasing Gavin. I said, listen, isn't it time that you married me or your daughter? Meantime, I've got Gandhi and Aaron, they're playing with. I'm teasing Gavin. There's no ways you marry my daughter. So, anyway, years go back, and he invites me to a bra, and Taryn and her friends are there. And I said, geez, thanks, Gavin. I see, you've invited me because you want to get me into water. I can call you dad. Go away, man. a long story short, at the end of the day, Taryn says, good night, Dad. I'm going to Toby Joe's. So anyway, I stayed. I carried on braying. About 45 minutes later, I said to Gavin, hey, Gavin, cheers. Thanks for the bra. I'm going to Toby Joe's. And he didn't put two and two together. And I really did go to Toby Joe's and I had my friend, Lee Spankenberg, there, who was my housemate in Summer Strand. And when we got to Toby Joe's, Taryn was there. And she said to me, listen, my friends have had too much to drink and all that.
No, you're going to mess the story up. Before okay, that stuff.
Yes.
I wake up the next morning.
Yeah.
In my driveway is his vehicle. Now I'm under pressure.
Okay.
Because he's told me the
he's
whole night
Joe,
he's going to get busy with my daughter.
Yes.
And I've told him, I'll kill you.
I kill you.
I've phoned him. Yep. I said, Krika. He answered. I said, Krika, where are you? He says, Dad, Taryn and I would like some coffee. I smashed Taryn's door open. I'm embarrassed to say, when I didn't see him in the bed, I looked in the cupboard. What had happened was Taryn had been ditched by her friends.
Yes.
And Philip had kindly said, Taryn, take my car and he's got to live somewhere else. But that was the scariest
Taryn
time of my life.
I would like some coffee.
I spent a bit of time in the army. That was nothing on the scariness of that day.
Oh, I love it, Philip. I love it. Oh, classic. Oh, thank you, Philip, man. You're a legend.
Cheers.
That's a beautiful story. Beautiful
Cheers, boy.
Story. You get him on the edge. You get him on the edge. Ciao, Philip.
He's a shocker. That is a shocker, Gino. That is a shocker. But I love him to bits. I wouldn't have it any other way.
Taryn, I would like some coffee, please. Yeah, Judith DeVet says, how's Gavin? Best storyteller. Gavin told Gino about the time Bobby was playing a tennis match and he served in the ball went missing.
Oh, God.
He couldn't find it.
That's the same Bobby Rogers that
yes.
That was
the cricket player.
The cricket player, yes. Yeah. And there's a squash story as well.
Is he still around, Bobby Rogers?
Bobby's in Plett. Okay. Him and Dyer are probably one of the better...
Somebody tag Bobby, please, if he's still around.
Bobby and Dyer are probably one of the better estate agents in the Plett area. Great friend of mine. But Bob first introduced me to his non-ball skill ability.
Oh, right. Yeah.
On the squash court, but that's a long story. But the tennis story was when he joined the Oval...
Yeah.
And decided to play in the handicaps.
Okay.
And Bob was playing, he'd entered the singles and the mixed doubles. and Wendy's talking about the mixed doubles match, but before we get there, we'll talk about the singles match.
Yes.
Bruce Long phoned me and said, listen, Augie, I'm under pressure, because Bobby's phoned me, and he says he's playing John Trollope on Saturday morning in the handicaps, and he's asked me for some advice on how to beat John. And I said... You need to tell Bobby that he's not going to beat John Trump. and he should just enjoy
just
himself.
It. Yeah. Yes,
but Bobby actually arrived at Bruce's house on a Friday night and insisted.
Okay,
he wanted advice. So Bruce very cleverly said, Bob, I'll tell you what, JT has a suspect serve.
Okay.
But first of all, what are the handicaps? So... Bruce said to Bob, what are the handicaps? And Bobby said, I'm plus 40 plus 30, which means that in the odd games he needs 1 point, and on the even games he needs two to get the game.
Okay.
And he said, and JT? No, JT was minus something. So he's got to get a few points before he gets to love.
Yes, yes.
Because it's handicaps. Yeah. So Bruce, very astute tennis player, he says, so you only need 1 point in the odd games. Yeah, he says, I'll tell you what you do. Make sure you win the toss and then make JT serve. Is that the advice? So Bob, Bruce said, yeah, Bob, that's the only advice I can give you. So the next day, it was not a game that I would normally have watched, but I was there first. And Bruce was there, and I was told, Hogg, you're not allowed to stand outside and watch because you're going to laugh. You go inside. So I stood inside the bar watching through the window.
No joking.
And I watched the spinning of the rackets, and Bob won. And I said, yes, please.
Okay.
And Bob said, JT, you serve. And anyway, so Bob moved to the receiving side of the court, and JT went, fault, double fault.
Oh.
Game.
He's won the game.
Now they change, because it's odd game, so they change. And JT walks to receive serve from Bob now. And everyone's looking for Bob. I was hysterical at that stage because Bob had sat down next to the umpire's chair and was toweling down.
Already after one game.
He just stood there.
1 point.
Anyway, Bob lost 6-1-6, love.
Oh, dear.
It was very sad. Oh, dear. But then they went to mixed doubles. And we, Bruce and I went down to watch that for the same reason we watched the first game. And it was at Lawson Brown. Okay. And Bob was serving. And he was playing with Bruce Long's lovely wife, Annie.
Yes.
And they were playing against Elaine Jackson and, if I remember correctly, Bruce Molyneux.
Okay.
And Bobby was serving, left-hander. And he gave an almighty swing with a racket that Martin Neft had given him. A brand new Adidas racket. Brand new.
Okay.
And yeah, he served. And there was chaos because no one knew where the ball was.
Yeah.
And Bobby was so convincing.
Yeah.
He gave it one of those. Had a look. He was so convincing that even Elaine Jackson, who was receiving, gave it one of these.
Where's the ball?
The ball was stuck in his racket. But that wasn't the funniest, because the last thing Bobby did after giving all this story,
yeah,
the last thing he did was that.
Look up. It's even still there. It's still up there.
That was the end for me. That was...
classic. He's convinced everyone on his nice.
And Bobby, you know, Bobby has laughed at himself more than anyone I know, and he's a wonderful friend, and we've had a lot of laughs about that. Martin Neft, yeah, in fact, will remember the story that eventually when Bobby left the Oval, he got Garth Wright's Springbok tracksuit, which he put on. He took that beautiful racket that Martin had given him and he went to a professional photographer and he got a photograph taken.
Springbok.
He framed it, and when he left the Oval, he presented it to the Oval with the words written across the photograph, to all my fans at the Oval, love Bobby Lendl.
Love it. Oh, I love it.
That's a true story.
Oh, man. Robin Adair asked why you, Gary's putting a little note here. So Robin Adair, is a friend of yours there as well?
Yeah, the midget Adair.
Yes, he asked why you lost your temper and broke quite a few glasses at Old Grey.
Yes.
Did you break it?
There was another fines meeting that Philip Kricher chaired.
Right.
And we were all focused on Philip's humour and his ability to run a fines meeting.
Yes.
I was sitting, we'd showered and changed and everything. I think Blondie and I might have been going out later that night, but suddenly we got jeans on and suddenly my jeans were warm.
Right.
And we were sitting at those like deck sort of tables. Yes. And...
Yes, like benches.
And my good friend, Robin Adair, my best friend, Robin Adair, had pissed on me.
The
glasses and bottles were me chasing him through the Old Grey Club, picking up any bottle or glass I could find and throwing it at him. I was asked to pay a 250 rand bill for broken glasses and bottles.
No.
But that's a day, and I told you.
But it was worth every shot that you got.
Chlorine. And brake fluid.
All right.
Adair and Hogg, same thing.
Same jaw.
The same thing that happened at his house was that year that we beat Australia to win the Tri Nations.
Yes.
And Timmy, his beautiful missus, had baked this magnificent homemade bread.
Yeah.
And we were so excited. In fact, we were far too excited about that whole rugby game that David Emery suggested that he'd never watch rugby with us again. because we were too loud.
Yes.
But as we walked out, a big crowd at Robin's house, as we walked out of his lounge, through the dining room, going towards his bar, he picked up this loaf of bread and he scrum off past it to me, like the old days.
Yes. And
that big dive.
Yes.
And I got so excited, I drop kicked it over the balcony.
That's not very nice.
And arrived on Monday morning bearing gifts for Timmy and apologies of immense proportion.
I'm sure. Okay, yeah.
He brings the worst out of it.
Yes, I see that.
But I see there's another man. That's not Porgy, it's Porky. Porky Connor.
Porky, actually.
That could be a lot of fun. I heard he wasn't going to make it.
Porky Connor. Man. You're there.
Yo. Hello, Gav.
Hey, yo.
Hello, folks.
I'm glad we've got some of Gav's friends on here because they really bring out the worst in him.
This one especially. How you doing, boy?
I'm well, and you? You're looking great. I've been laughing at some of the old stories. But, Gavin, I've been
here
a long, long time. When he first arrived here in PE, I think from the Stein Club to the Penguin Cricket Club to the Bucks, Muir Road, by parties I used to have at Muir Road when I lived there. So I've known Gavin a long time. But one thing to ask Gavin, you have to tell the story about, there's one thing you don't do with Gavin. Don't ever take him on a boat.
Oh, you don't do well on boats.
I invited him for a weekend, him and his wife and family, to the Lightleys on the lagoon. They used to have those houseboats that you could hire. So we hired the one for Gavin. I think it was called the Regal Star. It was the biggest boat.
Is this in Neisner? Where is this?
His memory is brilliant.
Neisner Lagoon. Okay, yes.
I'll give you a quick story on how to sail these things. You've got to follow the buoys around. Otherwise, you get stuck, you see. So anyway,
yes.
As Gavin said earlier on, the first night away, you should really take it calmly, but we didn't.
Again.
We gave it hell. Anyway, there was a mate of mine, the late George McFadden, and his girlfriend and Gavin, and I think Gav's brother was there.
He was.
And we ended up having a party on the land at Lightleys. They had like a, for the hirers of the boats, they had a party place where you could go and brine and that, because we got there late and we couldn't sail, you see, so we decided to party.
Okay.
Well, eventually, to get us out of their party area, the owners turned the lights off, because this was now...
Haven't you got homes to go to? Yes.
So Zell entrusted me to her baby daughter, Taryn, who was only about 3 years old, 4 years old then. And who'd been, they had fallen asleep, the kids, you see, while we carried. So yes. I had to carry Taryn down the stairs, across the jetty towards the boat. But unbeknown to me, the tide had gone out. So the boat was stuck sort of up there. And I had to climb up to get onto, it was the gunwale of the boat. And holding Taryn, I couldn't put my hand and vault over. So in the darkness, I felt my way there and I put my foot on and I tried to give her a shove. And now I've got this little girl in my arms, and we're at the jetty, and I go up, and as I did, I slipped. And the gunwale of the boat went between my legs, and there I was, Taryn in my arms, excruciating pain, screaming, and all I could hear was, Hawkey, what have you done with Taryn? Where's Taryn?
Of course. Oh, my word. No, nothing. No. Care for your nuts, I'm afraid. That's it.
I'm afraid I won't leave, but that was the last thing on her mind.
Porky.
We were up early, and we got into the. We had our boat, and Gavin and his family had us, and we headed off. And Gavin hit a bank, hit a sandbank. We were on our way to the Featherbed Bay to go and dry. Yes. It was a beautiful day in Nasda.
Across the lagoon, Featherbed. That's lovely there. Yeah.
These boats used to tow a little, it was like a little dinghy behind, but I mean the dinghies were like a little shoebox. They were really unstable, unsteady little shoeboxes. So anyway, Gavin's crowd, they all come out onto our boat down. We've only got this one little dinghy because his boat's stuck on the bank. So we go off to spend the midday, and we have the bra, we ferry the family off and the kids and everybody onto the bank, and then Gavin and I take all the bra stuff and the plates and dishes and the bra, the meat and the wood, and we get to the shore and we have a lovely afternoon there, swimming and braing, and that. Now it's time to go back. So Gavin and I say, right, what we will do, we'll take all the bra stuff first and then we'll come back and get the kids and the wife. So we're going back there. I'm on the oars. Gavin is in there, and I'm raying myself across. It was only about 20 meters offshore, but there was a steep drop-off, you see, where we'd anchor the boat.
Yes.
So I get to the boat, and I'm about to lean up now to get that alongside. And Gavin, for some reason, I don't know why, he stood up. And with his weight, he's quite clumsy on a boat.
Ah, right.
We both ended up in the water. And I remember surfing, and I had tomatoes and lettuce came past my nose. And I was shouting to Gavin, catch the liquor, catch the bra, the whole lot had gone to the bottom.
Oh, no. Yes,
like Gino, the funniest part of that whole story was him telling me to catch the cutlery, which was a long time at the bar. It's
gone already.
And then I got the giggles, I nearly drowned.
Gavin's got lots of stories to tell, I'm sure.
I'm sure.
The time that Zell left you. Gavin, tell them the time that Zell left you at the Crom River. When when I was staying at St. Francis Bay, and we went through to, I think, Mike McAfee's place for a bra, and Gavin had had enough, and she left him at the Crom River with me.
No, Zella had enough, and she said, listen, I'm going now, taking the kids home. I said, no, wait. She left.
Just one drink.
So I turned to Porky, and I said, Porky, you need to take me home. I did chase the car. I said, wait, Zell. Anyway, they were gone. And then Porky said, relax, I'll take you home. But he didn't. He took me to Dave Ogden's place, which was next door. And we played matches until, I don't know, 4 or 5 in the morning. I was winning every hand. But what I didn't realize was Gary Rhodes, Dave Ogden, and Porky were losing on purpose. Just so that they so kept saying, double or quits. And as soon as it's quits, you can go.
Yeah.
But I was winning everything. So we stay another drink.
Another one.
Anyway, 5 o'clock or whatever, we left. And I said, Porky, you have no idea how much shit you've got me into. There's going to be drama. Anyway, he gets me up to the gate, and there's the gate locked. We can't get out of this. It's like a farm area. We can't get out. That's it. Yes. So now I'm hitting him over the head. There's lots of drama. He reverses. Now, I think he's going to reverse all the way down literally a K to Ogden's house.
Yeah.
Not 50 meters. Back into first gear in a brand new Audi. He races at that gate. At the last minute, he turns and he goes through a barbed wire fence and through another one onto the road, nearly kills us.
What?
We get home. I'm still panicked. I run into the room where Zell's sleeping. I wake up. I said, I'm terribly sorry. It was Porky's fault. She said, you woke me up to tell me that shit. The best part of that story was, besides the fact that he destroyed an Audi, a brand new Audi, and it had to be resprayed, the best part of that story is when we phoned Dave Ogden the next day. He said, you guys went to the servant's gate. There's another gate that was wide open.
Oh, my word. Porky, that's a terrible that story.
That man's mad.
No, much quieter. But I'm glad Gav came, because he's done a hell of a lot for the clubs and, you know, and his friends and everybody associates with our stun club days. Where, I mean, how we never got fired from our jobs is a mystery. Friday afternoon used to be, you know, it was we used to get there at 12 o'clock and get home at 12 at night,
all in the name of good relationships.
It wasn't so much about getting fired from our jobs, it was getting kicked into touch by our wives.
Yeah.
How did we survive that? Oh, you didn't. I forgot about that.
I didn't see the art of it. Azel was much more.
Very much so. Yeah.
Thank you. Thanks, Bobby.
Shot Porks. Love you lots.
No, one last thing.
What is this?
I can say... Old Grey have got a lot, their cricket side have got a lot to thank Gavin for, because during the 80s, I think it was, or the late 70s, most of the stars left, or they retired, or Graham Pollock went to Joburg, Wilkie went to, Chris Wilkins went to Natal, and Old Grey cricket section were struggling, and the whole club was struggling, and it happened to coincide with Gavin and Warmer closing down, and he moved over to Old Grey. And I don't know, he injected a bit of enthusiasm and fun into the club, which basically dying. And Gavin is an honorary Old Grey today because of what he does for Old Grey. And really, the true Old Greys appreciate what he did for the club as a whole, not only for the cricket section, but for the Old Greys in general. And I'd like to say thank you, Gav. And that's a pleasure.
Porky, that's kind of you to say that, but believe me, when I arrived at Old Grey, it wasn't dying. It might have needed a bit of
DLC.
But it wasn't dying. I never thought there was life after Warmer, I must be honest, but some of my happiest times from a cricket point of view was my time at Old Grey, and I've there. But thanks for saying those kind words, I appreciate it. And by the way, Porky, that wasn't in the 80s, that was in the 90s.
No, but I see this. Yes, I see there's still a strong Warmer contingent there in Old Grey that keeps the flag flying, it seems.
Gavin, Old Grey was the 90s, but I think...
Warmer was before that, yeah.
Warmer, that was in the 80s. No.
Yes, it was.
And another thing that I found at Porky while you're there, your name just reminded me, was the fact that Gav used to have the Playboy deodorant, was it deodorant stuff?
Yes,
Playboy deodorant franchise or something.
That was the start of my agency business, the Playboy deodorant agency, yes.
Because I know Wendy Thompson was telling me, she sent me a photo or two of her dressed in Playboy outfit. Doing a promotion.
Kissing Ashton Galpin, of all people.
Yeah, no.
I was shocked.
Oh, it was classic.
Lucky Ashton.
Yeah.
There we go. Yeah. So I
remember you kissing someone at a dinner, but we won't go there, but.
There's enough trouble already.
Oh, that's out. The lights went out. Yeah, I remember.
Okay, so... Okay, well, thank you, Porky. Before we get into cuck online,
cheers, guys.
Thanks, folks. I love you lots. Thank you, bud.
Classic. No, I love it. You know, all these small things that happen, you know, that you remember over the years. I love the fact that it builds relationships. It builds things.
Gino, my whole life's been about that. Yeah. I mean, I've got three passions in my life. My family, obviously. Yeah. I've got two wonderful kids and two grandkids and a daughter-in-law that's fantastic.
And a very understanding wife.
An extremely understanding wife. And there's not one person out there that doesn't acknowledge that.
No.
And most of them are shocked by the fact that we've managed to make 44 years. But yeah, she's like a castle lager. She's... Yeah. Definitely stood the test of time.
Yeah, for sure.
Then the Cerebos brand, you obviously know about. Yeah. But a lot of people say sport was my passion.
Yeah,
it wasn't. Yes, I love playing sport and lots of it, and very many different types of it.
Yeah.
But it was never that was never really the passion. The passion was my mates and the people involved in those sports. Mm-hmm. And still to this day, my hockey that I still play, my golf that I still play, it's about those mates.
It's about the social, because you enjoy it.
That is my passion. And that's who I am. There have been times when I've needed to apologize for that, but my life can't.
To your wife, maybe.
No. Blondie, believe it or not, Blondie understands better than most. Yeah. Sure. Maybe took a while.
But no, just a quick history before we go to we got a little video from Mickey Arthur as well. We're gonna stick.
Barfly.
Yes, Barfly. We got him. We got a little thing from him. But just a quick history. Born.
No, I was born in Ndola on the Copper Belt in Zambia.
Zambia. Okay.
Or Northern Rhodesia, which in 1964 became Zambia, and I probably sang the loudest. Stand and sing of Zambia, proud and free.
Yes,
I was very proud of that lot. Loved Kenny Kaunda. I got a story about him and Betty, but maybe that's not for now. Zambia, went to school, was sent to boarding school eventually in Kimberley.
I think Zambia, the other guest that I've had on from Zambia was Robin Auld.
And believe it or not, Adrian Gardner.
Oh, yes. Yes, that's right.
And that train that Adrian talks about, that he used to travel from Zimbabwe or southern Rhodesia to Cape Town, is the same train I used to catch from Kimberley to Lusaka. It was 4 days and four nights on a train. It was only school kids and students.
Okay.
I was from Standard 5 to Standard 8, so probably too young to really...
CBC.
CBC Kimberley.
CBC, okay.
Probably too young to really enjoy the fruits of 4 days and four nights on a train, but certainly learned a lot of the shit that I know today on that train trip.
It's a long
great
trip.
Fun. I saw 40,000 green cushions fly over the Vic Falls on many occasions. And on my very last trip, noticed that in Bulawayo, they removed all the cushions.
Oh, really?
On the way home on the one trip.
Okay.
So, but yeah, great times.
And so school CBC right the way through?
No, my folks moved from Zambia to East London halfway through my Standard 8 at CBC, and I was always keen to get home.
Yeah.
I wasn't a great boarder, to be honest. It was never my favorite spot. And Kimberley was a bad place to. Having said that, I had great friends there, and it was a flippin' good school. Great school.
Yeah.
But boarding school wasn't really for me, and I finished my schooling at De La Salle in East London. Remember, I sang the war cry for you.
Yes,
you must concentrate.
I remember that. Yes, he did.
But De La Salle also, some great mates there. I remember Vivian Hansen, Tony Mead, great mates from that. Peter Allam, who ended up playing for Border. Ivan Pochnik, really good friends of mine.
Yeah.
Great school. Never a great sporting school, but possibly where I learned the most about how to play with a very mediocre side against the top side and fight like hell.
Fight,
And that went through my entire sporting career. I've always been able to say, well, we might not be the best, but we're going to give you a run for your money. We lost most, but we fought hard. And once I got to Old Grey, we won most. And I often wondered why the hell I ever went to Warmer. Because I should have just gone to Old Grey to start with, and we could have given Warmer a hiding. That's a joke. That's a joke. But irrespective of which club or which school I've been to, I've met so many great people, and I've had lots of fun. And like what was suggested earlier, I hate laughing.
And all
my friends that I associate with are with me, and they make me laugh. And
they have good times. Relationships is everything.
And getting back to what you and I discussed earlier on in the week.
Yes.
How to get people in our immediate community to actually believe that life is actually great.
Yeah.
And times are tough.
Yeah.
I get that.
To encourage.
And,
you know,
and in certain walks of life, yours, the entertainment sector, the travel sector, the hospitality sector, guys are bleeding big time.
Yeah.
But hold on to your sense of humor, and more importantly, hold on to that belief that if you reinvent yourself and find new ways to do things, you will survive this thing. We're all still alive.
Yeah.
Some of our close mates maybe didn't make it through COVID.
Yeah.
But we, even those that have really struggled through this thing, we're still here.
And the businesses...
And we can still win.
It's been hectic, but, you know, even if...
Don't give in.
And if the business falls... Fight on. Go to another spot. Fight. You
hundreds.
Know, because I so agree with that. Is that you've got to change tack. You have to do it. You know.
You've got to find a new direction. Yeah. If one direction is not working, find a new direction. I know we're getting serious, and this is not about that. But I'm very, very passionate about that thought. I mean, people like Philip Krieger is probably the funniest oak that I know.
Yeah.
Has done just that.
He's made
you,
it out of
you and Gary are busy doing just that. And that
forced impressed, to do it.
That I find amazing.
Yeah, we've got to. And another thing I was we were talking about with Charles Garay the other day as well is the guys that have the retirement age is no longer a factor. Yeah. Graham Clarkson with you guys now. He's finished with Spa. He's doing fantastically there. But he's got so much to give. He's got a wealth of experience.
Not only has he got a wealth of experience. He's got passion and he's got energy like you cannot believe.
Yeah.
A great friend. The only problem with that guy, similar to Robin Adair, When we were in India, and I forgot to tell the story.
Yes.
The late Norman Minow.
Yes.
Myself was sitting in the back seat of a taxi. Clarkson was sitting in the front seat of a taxi. We were driving through Calcutta in India. Now,
Busy.
People in this country don't have any idea what the traffic looks like in Calcutta. But in any event, Clarkson managed to make it worse by instructing the taxi driver to run into a shop to see if they were selling leather jackets. While that oak ran into the shop, Clarkson stole the taxi.
Oh, nice. Good idea, Clarkson.
He then proceeded to try and do a U-turn in a Hillman that wasn't capable of doing a U-turn on that road. He left the Hillman diagonally across this road and caused the biggest traffic jam in history. There is no traffic jam bigger than the one he caused. He and Minard dived out of the car and ran.
And left you.
And hid. The only reason I didn't dive out of the car and run because I was laughing too much.
Oh.
When the cops arrived to arrest me for stealing the taxi,
of course,
I was only saved by the fact that the senior officer pointed out to his juniors that it was fairly impossible for the oak sitting in the back of the car to steal the taxi.
Right. Yes, yes.
One of the youngsters did ask, but he must know who the perpetrators were. And they said, well, we're not going to ask him. Why are we not going to ask him? Because I just signed his an autograph as Clive Rice.
Oh. Yes. And they are crazy about cricket.
Yes, they are. They are not just crazy about cricket. Those are the most knowledgeable supporters of cricket ever.
It's because they bet on it all the time.
But they really do. Even the lighties. They really know their cricket. For sure. Incredible people. Sure.
Now we've got a last guest. Just one more. Stick on your headphones. We've got a little message here from. We've got a message, I think, from Michael Arthur from the Barfly, all the way from Durban.
You guys are doing well,
Barfly.
I thought I'd rather send a little message as opposed to try and do a live connection with you guys. The internet connection up here is about as dodgy as the Pirates Buccaneers defense. So this is quite I just want to say, I know it's going to be a great show. I'm sure the guy's queuing up to tell stories about Gav. He's an absolute legend in PE Abeja sports. And unless my parachute doesn't open or I get knocked over by a train, I'm pretty sure that I'm going to be dying after Gavin Hogg, which makes my heart very happy, which means he will not be speaking at my funeral. As lovely as an MC as he is, I've been to a couple of funerals with Gavin Hogg and they never turn out well. Going to that many funerals with him also explains to you the average age of our hockey team. But the last funeral that I went to with Gavin was for a good friend of ours, Keith Bullion, who is lovingly known as Head. And his son got up and gave a very moving eulogy. He had everyone in tears for about 5-6 minutes. The poor guy himself broke down about 6-7 times. So it went on quite a bit. And then Gavin Hogg got up. And in his first 30 seconds, he had said the word shit 2 or 3 times. And then proceeded to talk about the time that Keith Bullion went out to bat with nothing but a ball box in his underpants. So that's the kind of guy that Gav is, and I think that's why he's loved so much. He doesn't change for anyone. He doesn't change for anything. He's also a very humble guy. So in the times that we worked together at Pirates Hockey, I always had to hide how much he had actually done for the club. Whenever I had to get up and take all the praise for how well we were doing as a committee, Gav was always saying, please don't mention my name. Please don't mention my name. That's just the character of the man. So now that he's not here to tell me not to say it, Gav, thank you so much for everything you've done for Pirates Hockey Club over the years. All the things you do behind the scenes and you never want to take credit for. I know you're also involved with some smaller clubs around PE like Old Grey and that. And I'm sure they're very grateful for what you do as well. So enjoy the rest of your evening. Enjoy a couple of gins there. And have a great evening. And I look forward to catching up with you in the next couple of weeks, my bud. Stay well.
What a legend. Michael Arthur, absolutely brilliant
guy. Yeah, he's a great, man. He doesn't do himself any justice in terms of what he did for Pirates, but Yeah, that's very special. That's moving. Yeah.
No, it is, and I know that. I mean, even with my show, I think there was a show that we couldn't do. I was away doing a gig or something. It was one of the few times out of 200 shows. I think we've had probably twice that it's happened. And Mickey Arthur's been there for me every time.
He's a very funny man himself.
Brilliant,
great stand-up comic. Yeah.
I think before we finish off, a couple of comments. Let's see, sitting with GC Gavin.
GC's son Brett.
There we go. How many goals did you score against? Score against Bulawayo.
You know that goes back many years. We were playing Premier League hockey for Pirates at the time, so that's a long time ago. But Occasionals hockey side in Grahamstown invited GC and myself and Gavin Searle from Pirates to join them on a trip to Zimbabwe to play hockey. That trip started on light aircraft from the Grahamstown airport.
Ooh,
I remember Azel calling me to the window just before we were taken out to these light aircraft and saying, why is that oak pumping up? and seriously, that's how it was. A dramatic,
I call them
it was
buddy,
a dramatic start.
Buddy Holly planes.
So already they had a puncture, but
okay. Oh,
we were flying into Lanseria when Clarkson, who at the time on our plane anyway was co-pilot, which is then we really don't want that.
No
story. He turned around,
steal a taxi.
He forgot about Azel and I, but just said to his missus, "Buckle up," there was a drama, and the drama was that Biggles, our pilot, had worked out that the landing gear it wasn't indicating on the screen that the landing gear was down, so that there could be a problem.
Oh, right, okay.
We could crash land. But anyway, the landing gear was down. We landed, and ambulances and fire brigade, and everybody was surrounding us. It was chaos. But we eventually made it to Zimbabwe. And we played games in Bulawayo, Harare, and we did a bit of a tour of Vic Falls, which was great. But the Bulawayo trip was specific to that question that Brett's asking. Was we arrived in Bulawayo, and Graham's wife, Azel, and I were sent to stay with a guy by the name of Andy Bint, who at that time was the All-Africa goalkeeper. Okay. So he was proper.
Good.
He was proper.
Didn't let anything pass.
Anyway, we'd had a few drinks that night when I informed Andy in front of Blondie, the barman, who was called Blondie because he was so black he was blue.
Okay.
I informed Andy that on the next morning when we played hockey, I was going to get a hat trick.
Okay.
Simple as that. I didn't care. Yeah. I didn't care what his pedigree was.
Okay.
I was going to get a hat trick. And I had 1,000 shots at that fool and scored nothing. And in fact, in those days when they didn't have a sweeper like Dave Dampier is for us now, they had two backs, a left back and a right back. And at one point they had a 16-yard hit and the left back rolled the ball to me and the two backs stood apart and said,
"Go for it.
Have a go."
They kind of knew.
And Andy saved that as well.
Okay.
And Clarkson and Searle and the rest of them were laughing a lot because while I was doing all that shit, Clarkson got a hat trick.
Oh, nice.
And we won 3-2.
Oh, no, so that's, oh, there we go.
That wasn't one of the happiest moments of my life, and it's plagued me. I mean, that happened in the 80s. And these clowns are still talking about it.
Still,
I mean, let it go.
No, they'll bring it up. They'll bring it again.
And GC's just driven up to Joburg to spend time with his son. And they're just sitting there working out. Yeah, they're sitting there working out ways to embarrass me.
Graham, I need to have you on the show sometime as well. We need to reciprocate with some stories. Ian Lee is saying, enough time for an army story.
Not too many of those. Chris Kennedy's got all those stories, and not my favorite time.
Let's have a look at some others here. Gav, how about the time you took us to Elwell? Two blonde chicks. Hey.
Lee Wiley.
It looks like all three blonde chicks.
Two blonde chicks, yeah, that's true. Lee Wiley, big friend of Azel's. Yes. I was repping at the time, and Elwell North was part of my route list.
Right, okay.
And Azel, as my girlfriend, informed me that she wanted to go on a country trip with me.
Oh, nice. To check up, you know.
I said, well, that's quite difficult, but you must remember I've got calls to do. She said, no, don't worry, Lee's coming with us.
So the wine drinkers.
So I said,
check that.
But I said, but how's that going to work? I've literally got to go through Queenstown and Sturkstrom and all those places. And no, don't worry, we'll look after ourselves. And anyway, I got to Elowell and I was then informed that neither of them had money. So now I've got, the only money I had in those days was the money the company gave me to book into the hotel. So now there's drama. Yeah. So I booked in and had enough, I scraped up enough to book my missus in.
Oh, but so, still
so Blondie's in, but Lee must stay in the car.
We make a plan.
So now we sorted out our booking. I said, yeah, no, my missus with me. We book in and anyway, we off we go. Now we're in the room. Now I'm saying, now girls, now what's going to happen now?
Yeah.
No. They've worked out that tonight there's a party at the Springs.
Oh, okay.
Hot springs. We're going there. I said, no, that's not really what I'm talking about. I'm talking about how are we going to get through this? There's three of us in this room now. And
check.
I stay here a lot. Yeah. And these people are going to... Anyway, now we do this thing. But they decide, now let's go and have supper. I said, no, we can't have supper. So Zell and I went for supper.
Yes.
But the whole way through supper, Zell was stealing food, putting it in a serviette or something to take back to Lee.
Yes.
And Lee then ate her food in the room, and then we went to the party, and we had a massive party, because we always had money for the party.
Yes, of course.
So we had a massive party at the Springs, and we came back, we all had a kip. I think I was the one that slept on the floor. But the next morning, I said, so now what happens? No. Lee's turn to get a meal, so you must take Lee to breakfast. But now Zell's here, and Lee's here.
Yes.
But she puts the Zell's kit on from the night before to make it look like it's normal. They're both blonde.
Yes.
I take Lee to breakfast. Lee's putting breakfast into a serviette for Zell.
Yes.
Anyway, she goes back to the room. Now I go check out.
Yeah.
The receptionist says, Mr. Hogg, you've been a great guest of ours for a long time, but the manager wants to see you.
I said,
what about? She said, well, you'll see. And I walked into the manager's office, and all he said to me was, Mr. Hogg, how foolish do you think we are? She said, the one chick you brought in here last night is this tall, ours is tall. We're going to let you off because you're such a good customer, and we thought it was quite funny. Don't do it again.
So, Gav can't pull the wool over their eyes.
Yeah. No, but it was them. It wasn't me. Trish, I didn't do that.
Nothing. Trish Stapleton, Trish, our hearts go out to you because you've got a sick man in your house, and it must be...
Don't listen to him, Trish. He's lying. Nothing wrong with him.
Sore stomach, sore lips, sore this. It must be just hell for you. Tracy Walter says, one of the best cricketers ever.
Yeah.
Golf, though, need a lot of lessons, apparently.
No. What she's talking about is on Saturday, Matt, her son, is going to be my partner at Humewood.
Oh, okay.
He's a youngster, but he plays for EP.
Oh, magic.
And I'm going to give a couple of old codgers at Humewood a hiding on Saturday.
That's Gerald's son.
Matt is playing with me on Saturday. And
excellent.
The two of us are arriving as passionate young golfers to give those old codgers at Humewood a hiding.
Yes. Best of luck. Best of luck to you there. For that as well. Yes, I'm also, this is Gary DeBrain solo is given to us.
Gary DeBrain.
The legend.
Wonderful man. Deserves all the success he gets out of this lot.
The Fitcher Leeds, for sure.
A great man in the industry that I played in for many years.
And
a super guy. Does a lot for clubs in this town. Mm-hmm. And deserves all the success,
said. Absolutely. Vicky Hodder says, go Bubba from Dylan.
Vicky, that's David's stepdaughter. Yes. Lovely girl.
Jeffrey Pudney.
Yeah, Pudney, that's from the UK, Bubba, I would imagine.
From the Mighty Island. Smugglers are always better than the Bucks. I heard about the smuggler stories.
Hard luck, Puds. This is not true.
Lots of Pudneys around Walmart. It was before.
There's fires.
We've got some Pudneys up here at the road in Thomas Road.
His fires.
Fires. How's it, Fires? Nice to see you online as well. And Joss saying, how's it?
Josso.
Gary Levat.
Gary Levat,
Levat.
Ex-Nestle boy.
Oh, Nestle. Excellent.
Big mate of old schoolmate of mine, Tony Mead.
Oh, and Tony,
second naughtiest man on the planet. They still got the top spot taste.
I see you've got Lynn saying, how's it as well? Well, thank you that.
Dave's missus.
Yes, of course. Alexa.
That's saying, Sharon's daughter. Now, Alexa. Now, that's an interesting story. Alexa is one of my daughter's friends, but yes. I need to tell you a story just prior to my involvement in Alexa's wedding.
Yes, oh, she'd been married.
Was a great friend of ours at Hume, Colin Palm, and had a heart attack and passed away, unfortunately. Anyway, we were all gearing up for the funeral, and I got a call out the blue from Colin's son, Dan, who said, Gavin, I've never met you, but my dad always said, at this funeral, Hogg must talk. But there must be no priest.
Okay.
There's no church service.
Yeah.
But Hogg must.
Okay.
And I said, Dan, I'm more than happy to do a eulogy.
Yeah.
I love Colin Palm to bits. He said, no, that's not actually what I'm asking you to do. I'm asking you to run the service.
All right.
which clearly is pressure.
Yeah, well, you're an altar boy, I suppose.
Anyway, to see. The best part of that story was when I arrived at First Avenue Funeral Parlor to do the story.
Gillespie.
All those clowns that are out there watching and were at that funeral had left one parking bay open for me.
Oh, nice.
The pastors.
Oh, really?
So,
lucky for you.
I parked in the pastor's parking bay, and then I did my business in that funeral. It was a very sad day, but I did my bit. Yes. And so I was known for a while as Pastor Hogg.
Oh, right.
And that word got out.
Oh, yes.
Because when Alexa got married, she was already legally married.
Oh.
She married a wonderful guy from Holland.
Ah,
and they then wanted to do the whole story in Stellenbosch.
Okay.
As for their South African friends, and as a family member of one of her best friends, my daughter Taryn, we were invited, Zell and I. So we arrived in Cape Town, and I'd been asked right up front to do the MC's job, which I'd agreed.
Yes.
So on the night before the wedding, we'd gone to this braai, the family braai, and we were considered part of the family, which was fantastic.
Yes.
And we braai, and then I noticed that there was a bit of angst.
Okay.
And I was then called to one side and informed that because of COVID, it was like literally the Thursday we were all told to be at home for lockdown.
Oh, jeez, like, okay.
It was the Tuesday.
So that's like March 2020.
So there was a lot of panic. And the first act of panic was the
priest.
The priest.
So
who bailed.
He bailed for the wedding.
So I was then pulled to one side and told that, well, listen, you've done a funeral. Can you do a wedding?
The right Reverend Hogg is going to be doing the wedding.
And I did that wedding. I don't know how well I did it, but I will tell you that the last thing my son gave me some really beautiful religious matter to use in this wedding.
Always helpful when you're
that way inclined. He's that way inclined, my son, a wonderful boy. But I do remember. The only part I remember was right at the end, as I said to Alexa and her husband, I, Pastor Hogg, pronounce you man and wife.
Ah, nice.
And that will stay with me for the rest of my life. And that Alexa, I'm sure, remembers.
Oh, lovely. A good Catholic boy. We can do anything if we need to. I don't know if there's any more for the last couple of... Oh, she's having a good laugh.
There she says.
Yvonne McGregor saying, loving this.
Sal's best friend.
There we go. Anika.
Anika was a buyer at Spa, but before that worked with me in my agency business. A wonderful, wonderful lady.
Theo Leach saying, Gavin, you're so good to see this. Mr. Cricket out of Thornhill in the braai afterwards.
You.
Cricket dropping catches. Oh my.
That was beautiful too. Cricket dropping catches. That was the day he agreed to go to the boundary. Because he always wanted to field close, but he went to the boundary that day, Cricket. Only because there was a gorgeous chick lying on the embankment next to the grandstand in a bikini.
And
Cricket was One of these. No,
I understand.
I don't think it was 4 catches. I think it was closer to 10.
Oh, classic. Oh my God, let's have a look. Davina shouting hello from off the hook at PE Harbour.
Yeah.
Oh, excellent. Off the hook, haven't you?
There's Alexa.
Spot. There we go. The time of marriage, official marriage. There we go.
Yeah.
There we go. Even the priest bombed out due to COVID. She says, I gather we're talking Oval Tennis Club. Some legendary stories come out of that.
Yeah, there's some big stories there. But mostly the woman that stripped in that bar. Shocking.
Shocking.
That's why I left that club eventually.
You know, really, I'm sure he left that because
there's Andre Fischer there. He needs to jump out there. If you can find Andre Fischer. Andre Fischer,
there we go. Let's click on that one.
You need to find him.
I know about Hogg and all his boating abilities. There we go.
Fischer was trying to reverse his boat into the Krom River on a particular day, and unfortunately for him, the world famous Dion van Wyk
on the trailer
and the less famous Gavin Hogg arrived to assist.
Oh dear, yes.
And we'd been drinking most of the day. Anyway, we got onto the boat,
yeah.
And that particular launch slipway was just two narrow cement strips into the river.
Yes, that's not good.
So our job was
to check. Lungs.
Check.
Lungs.
Yeah.
Come. Yeah.
So okay. Dion was the caller.
Okay.
So he was saying, come. And I was looking down, but my section was widening.
All right.
And okay. I kept saying, Dion, there's a drama here. This is widening. And he kept saying, come. Anyway, eventually that trailer fell into the river, but it was with a crash and a lot of broken stuff because that cement was high and there was a lot of drama.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
And all I remember is after all the noise and the scratching and the crashing and the swearing from the car,
yes.
Van Wyk was heard to say, whoa. That's when I ran.
calm.
Whoa.
Tanya Buchanan is saying, how's it? Tanya, you're the same. Absolutely amazing lady, that Tanya. I love it to bits. Mike Povey saying, well done, Gav. Excellent. Peter Wolfrey saying, well done. Positive words for all of us. Thank you. Graham.
Rango, you.
Here we go.
There's a naughty fella.
And he loves you. Look at that.
I love you too, my boy.
Robert Kane.
Robbie Kane lives a long way from here now, but he was a stalwart at Warmer. And I know you'd lost your dad recently, Robbie. That was a wonderful man. His smile will always be in my head and the way he supported you. But we still miss you at Warmer and at Old Grey, Rob. Even if I took your place at Club Champs, I just wanted to throw that in there.
Excellent. And we're right here in Warmer Rob's, how's it? Your biscuit? Tough corner. Says, come on, Warmer.
Yeah, but spell it properly, Tufty.
That's a dodgy way of spelling it. There we go. Di Rogers saying, how's it as well? Tell about your squash.
You see, that's Bobby Rogers' wife. Now, I didn't think Di would ever ask me to tell that story.
Yeah, no.
Bobby Rogers. Okay, the last one about Bobby.
You've been priming this story about the squash.
No, I didn't want to tell that story. But you know that if someone walks into your office, Bobby and I used to work in the same building. In East London, actually. And that's long before the tennis debacle and the cricket debacle. Yes. But when someone walks into your office and challenges you to a game of squash, you assume
that they can play.
That he can play.
Yeah.
Now, at the time, I didn't have any idea how to play squash. But I knew my dad had an old squash racket. You know those towel handles and the Dunlop and the little head about this big?
Yes.
So I borrowed that from my old man. And I said, no, I'll play you Friday, lunchtime.
Okay.
Bob, I'll give it a go.
Yeah.
And I thought, I'm going to get a hiding. Yeah.
Play squash. I mean, we played here
and then we arrive at the West Bank Golf Club. They had the squash court up at the top. But you had to walk through the pub to get to the change room.
Yes.
And he walked through and he flicked the coin to Somfy the barman. I'll never forget. Okay. Somfy, when you see us go up there, switch the lights on. So, shit, this boy's been here before. We go into the change room and typical Bob, the best kid. His racket looked very different to mine.
Fashion, like Gavin Loon. Gavin Loon.
No, you can never look as good as Gav Loon.
Okay.
Yeah, that's something different.
Right.
Remember, slide uphill. Man.
Yeah, okay.
But Bob had all the right kit. So I thought, I'm going to get a hiding here.
Yeah.
Anyway, we got onto the court. And Bob said, well, look, we haven't got time to like warm up. Let's just play. Because then we're going to go to lunch, go back to work. Okay, so I said, well, okay, well, you serve.
Yeah.
And Bob's left-handed, but he started off right-handed.
Oh, dear.
And I have to show this, unfortunately.
Yeah, okay, let's get the front camera then. We'll get this.
And Bob...
There you go.
Bob, he looked at me. He started off with the racket in his left hand. Yeah, and he looked at me, and I had my racket in my right hand. So he changed. And I thought, you know, this looks left-handed. But he's now decided, so I'm so crap, he's going to stuff me up right-handed. And he threw the ball up, and he missed it by a foot.
Yeah.
And he had another go, and he missed it by a foot, and he picked the ball up. Then I said, Rob, stop cocking around. I just hit, play left-handed.
Yeah.
He turned around, he threw the ball up, and he missed that by a foot. He missed it again. And then I realized he'd never hit a squash ball in his life. And he was never going to. So I threw my racket into that corner of the court. I fell over laughing here. He looked at me for a while. He threw his racket into that corner. He fell over laughing. We laughed for 20 minutes and then went to lunch. Bobby and I, we didn't hit a ball.
Is that what he said? He's such a bad boy. Actually, not a squash
player. And Di brought that up. I never thought she would bring that. Hopefully Bob's listening to this crap.
Tufty, sir, what about the dog ass sniffing? Was that the cricket?
Tufty, you obviously came in late. We'd done it.
We spoke about cricket. Phillips cricket spoke about that. Yeah, we did. Neil Thompson, Tomo's on there. My turn watching you. Yes.
Yeah, Tomo. We've had a I've watched that man. That man has given Hazel and I and all our friends lots and lots of great evenings.
Happy times.
The old anchor. Yeah. That man is a genius.
Yeah,
still today. In fact, just not so long ago, probably not that recent, but not so long ago, at Slobby Brietsky's house, Tomo entertained us. And he's one of the most magnificent entertainers I've ever seen
met.
And at one time he told me he was going to stop playing, and that would have been the end of all great music, other than yours, of course.
Yeah,
I think we played a role in keeping
him. We got him in.
No, he's an incredible man.
Tomo, like when he says not playing, I think it means not playing for money.
he could do that or not, but he's given so much entertainment to so many people.
Man. Sean Sannon saying,
Sean Sannon,
thank you, man.
One of the funniest guys I've ever met as well, but along with Warren Rogers.
Yes.
Warren Rogers, Bobby's brother.
Yeah.
Once asked, Sean, why he had such a big nose. He said, I don't know, Warren. I was born with this thing. What did he say? He said, why have you got such a big nose? No, you've got such a big nose.
Yeah.
He said, I don't have such a big nose. He said, why do you pick such a big one? Something like that. In fact, I cocked that up completely. But sure.
But why did you pick such a big
one? Did you pick your nose as a youngster? He said, yeah. He says, I think I might have. He says, why did you pick such a big one?
That's right. Did you help me out? I'll take that. Oh, maybe I'll use that. Okay.
But Sean, also one of the funniest guys I know.
Keith Clark saying, top show. Thanks, man, Keith.
Mr. Holt.
Mr. Holt.
Yeah, that was a golf ball. There was a golf ball that at St. Francis ended up in someone's, through someone's window.
Oh, jeez. Not Gavin.
I'm sure he was a Nazi because he ran out and his missus and they attacked me for hitting this golf ball through their window.
Oh, dear.
And I apologized profusely.
Yes.
I was with Carlo and a few of the boys from Old Grey, and I apologized profusely. I said, I promise you I didn't do it on purpose, but really, I'll make good as soon as the game's over.
Yes.
I'll pop in and I'll make good. And they demanded immediate recompense. They wanted money immediately. And I was being attacked so vociferously that eventually I got to the point where I'd also lost the plot.
Okay.
And I informed these Nazis that I was going to finish my game of golf.
Yes.
Whether they liked it or not.
Yeah.
And they should move along.
Yes.
And when it was suggested they were going to call the cops, I said, call squad cars, do whatever you like. But I'm going to finish my game. And when I'm ready, I'll come along here and I'll sort it out. And I said, and by the way, I don't have to sort anything out. You bought your house on this golf course. My ball's gone through your window. It's unlucky. Yeah. Anyway. We got to the clubhouse, and the clubhouse was packed.
Yeah.
it was really a full evening at St. Francis Bay Golf Club. And as I walked in, the cops were there with these two Nazis.
She's like...
And so I ducked and ran through the crowd, got what it, I was looking for something in the change room, and then I went back to my car. But as I was running out, they saw me and they were shouting. I had told them my name was Hogg and that I'd be back. Yeah, and they said, Mr. Hogg! Anyway, they chased me to the car.
Okay.
Where they found myself and the Italian, who had remained calm to that point.
Yeah.
But it was at that point that the Italian remembered that at some point in the Second World War, the Germans
changed,
and the Italians parted.
Sides.
And he informed those Germans that enough was enough.
Okay.
And my temper could just stay calm while he went mad. Okay. Anyway, the next day I did feel bad.
Yes.
And it was just before Christmas, in fact.
Oh,
it was,
there
it
we
was
go.
December.
You know, it's the time.
So I bought, a Christmas card. And I wrote a little note to these people, plus the money that they had demanded from me.
Okay, right, okay.
Less a little bit.
Yes, okay.
And I wrote this little note, and I invited them to, I said, Merry Christmas, I invite you to join in the spirit of Christmas and not be so aggressive and wada, wada, wada. And then at the bottom I said, here is the money required by you for your, fixing your window, less 20 rand.
Yeah.
And that's for the ball you stole from me.
The ball.
Oh,
you could have just sold them. You could have knocked them out like you knocked out your wife that time with your elbow.
No.
Watch out for the elbow. Brendan Kelly, how's it, Brendan? Nice to see you as well. But it blows my mind is how so many of us are intertwined in PE. It is a village. This is a village. We're in Warmer right here, but yet we've got people across the road talking about Warmer, and I just love it. Andre van Rooyen.
Good evening.
How's it, Andre? Like it. Have you as well.
I can't believe how many people are on this thing, and it shows you how easy it could be to get people together to make this place a more special place.
You know, to connect the people in PE with you know, I found with this show as well, because there's so many people that have been on, and I often have a story from one person that I can say, well, what about this guy here? Just link up here. I think we've
but we can
do
so much for this place, and I'm going to do something with you.
We'll make a plan.
Here's my brother Neil Hogg.
Here we go, and Anthony Cohen is saying the last
time. The honky at church, there's my boot, honky at church. That was that story I told earlier.
Yes.
At the long clanger.
Yeah, geez, like Carlo Giacconi as well, because my fellow Italian. Mark Hensberg saying, how's it?
Tomo and El Cid, yeah.
Oh, Rogers.
Johnny Coombs.
Tony Coombs saying, how's it slowly with those gins? We've got the whiskies and the gins here going on.
Gaino
saying, how's it?
One of Vazel's and my partners at our St. Francis home. Lovely lady.
Excellent. Camilla Ellis, laughter is the best man. It's a brilliant show. Thanks, Camilla. Camilla's involved in the Warmer Library, so she's also a warmer stalwart here. Wendy Thompson.
PE is special. You're right, Wendy.
You're right. It is. Absolutely. And we've had a lovely evening of comments. Thanks, guys, for the comments you've sent through. Now, Gav, to end off the show, we always ask our guests when they've had an embarrassing moment or a moment when something's gone completely wrong, when something's gone really, it's just been a cock-up of note, because people like to hear those stories, because everybody likes to hear somebody else's failure or where there's a bigger bugger-up. And then also your proudest moment, other than the birth of your children. Sort of those two juxtaposition.
Or my marriage.
Or your marriage. No, you're not allowed to say that.
My worst time.
Yes.
And I'm surprised Blondie's not jumping onto the bandwagon here. But
yes.
Just off the top of my head, there are probably thousands of bad moments.
Everybody has those, but it is one specific.
But the real specific bad moment involves quite a few of my mates, but... Yeah. It was the time I invited the entire Oval Tennis Club to a steak evening at my house.
Oh, yes.
On the Saturday evening.
Yeah.
Was playing no sport that Saturday, so I thought it was a great idea to...
And prepare.
Prepare, get everything organized.
Yeah.
And Blondie had said, oh, that's a great idea. So a lot of people were coming to my house that Saturday night.
Yeah.
Anyway, on the Friday at about 10 o'clock that evening, David Emsley had phoned me to say They were one short for the game against Utenag.
Oh, shit, okay.
Anyway, so...
Utenag as well. Oh, my word.
I'd indicated to Azel that, listen, I'd really like to play that game. And she said, no, you can play cricket.
Yeah.
But I'm telling you now, you are in charge of the steak evening.
Yes. I've heard those words echoing in my own head.
Anyway, so... The hundreds, man, I know what I'm doing. I've invited them. I know what's going on. And off I went. And I remember clearly going to cricket in my own car all by myself.
Yeah.
So my cricket kit and me, that's all in my car.
Yes.
Straight after the game, we were in the showers.
Yeah.
And in those days, no cell phones.
Yeah.
But there were at the Utenag ground, there was a tiki box in the clubhouse.
Yes.
And that someone came into the change room and said, there's a call for Gavin Hogg.
From the tiki box. Yeah, you used to find that box. And
I hadn't showered yet, but my cricket shirt was still on, but yeah. I had to use a towel to go to the clubhouse, take the call, and it was Blondie to say, Hogg, just to remind you, there's a dinner at our house tonight, and you in charge.
Yes.
I said, Azel, if you hadn't delayed me with this phone call, I would have been well on my way.
Yes, of course.
You know, I went back, showered,
and
was convinced to go to the pub for one.
One beer.
People like Aubrey Nell, Dave Hansen, Aubrey Nell from Utenag, Dave Emsley,
yes.
Dion van Wyk, idiots that I've surrounded my life with.
So irresponsible people.
At about 9 o'clock that evening, Dion van Wyk, who had left, came back into the pub and said, boys, you need to be careful. There's a traffic
roadblock
opposite VW.
Ah.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah,
probably. Anyway, at about midnight.
Oh.
I remember Dave Emsley still with a cricket helmet on his head and myself carrying Christo Borsoff, our opening batsman, to my car. Now, remember, I got there by myself. I don't know what happened to their cars.
Yes.
But we put him on my back seat. He was passed out. Emsley got into the...
With his, at least he was wearing his
helmet. But still with his helmet on in case we...
Safety first.
Safety first, yeah.
Yes.
And we'd all forgotten about the warning about VW. But anyway... As I went past VW, I swerved to miss a cop.
Oh.
And stopped 200 meters past him.
Yes.
Emsley suddenly was sober and suggested that maybe I reverse because we're in shit now.
Okay. Yes.
And I said, well, so you want me to hit him this time? I said, I'm staying right here.
Yes.
And this cop arrived at the window and all I said, I knew, there's drama here now, but now I'm in a hurry.
Yes, because you've got to get...
Because I've got to get to the dinner.
Right.
Remember, it's midnight. Yes,
it's midnight now. You've got to at least and there's gonna say
be,
goodbye.
There's going to be a thin-lipped viper at home as well.
Yes.
I said to the cop,
a good laugh, yeah.
How much? How much? He said, 85, sir.
Oh.
Now, the last person I needed help from was Christo Borsoff, who was passed up.
Yes.
He sat up.
Oh.
Bolt upright and said, excuse me for this, he said, 80 fucking rand. And this cop put his head through the window and said, no sir, 80 Ks, 120 fucking rand. We all laughed, we all thought that was very funny. He said, sir, how far you got to go? I said, no, just here.
Yeah.
He said, move along.
Okay.
Anyway, so we raced home.
Yes.
We kicked Borsoff out the car at his house because he was fast asleep.
Yes.
I think we left him on the pavement. Yeah. I then dropped Dave off at his house. He convinced me to still come inside.
Oh.
And I said, but why?
Because he's got a helmet.
I said, do you need help with your missus? He says, no. He said, I think I want to give you something to get you out of shit at home.
Yes.
And I said, well, what? He eventually gave me a can of Coke.
Oh.
I said, so how's this going to help? Yeah. He said, well, if you walk in with a can of Coke, you haven't been drinking.
Oh, yes, of course. Oh, that
really helped.
Yes, I'm sure that helped.
I remember walking into my home. The only people left were Bruce and Annie Long.
Yes.
And my missus.
Yes.
Obviously.
Yes, yeah.
It was a pity she hadn't gone home with the other people because it would have been much happier.
Bruce and Annie Long, such good friends.
And Bruce, the bastard, took one look at me and turned to Annie and said, Bookie, we're leaving.
Oh dear, okay.
And he left me to handle that terrible evening.
Oh dear. Okay,
on my own.
So well, he's still been married 44 years. What
yes, but that is no...
So that, was
that is not for anything that I did.
That's your bad. That's your bad cock. I'll give you that one. I'll give you that one.
A good one.
And then a proudest moment in your career, in your anything.
It's going to be cheesy, maybe.
Yeah.
There are others.
Yeah.
But the most recent.
Yeah.
Is being able to hand the reins over.
Yes.
To Kevin Duckworth, a man that. I believe I took from a job that he had at a sports shop.
Okay.
My first introduction to Kevin Duckworth was a great cricketer who couldn't play cricket because he worked for a sports shop who'd employed him because he was a great sportsman but wouldn't let him off on a Saturday.
Yes, couldn't get off to play.
So. I employed him, and I did a deal with Dave Emsley at the time, mm-hmm. where I said, Dave, this man will play for EP, and he eventually did.
Okay.
But Dave didn't have any way to pay for Ducky to play.
Yeah.
He didn't have a contract for Ducky.
Okay.
So I made a deal with Dave that said, okay, when he's not playing, I'll
employ him.
I'll employ him. But when he's not with me, you pay him.
Yeah.
Okay. And we did that for a couple of years, and Ducky... had a pretty successful career with EP, but then eventually came to me and said, I'm done with that. Yeah. I've got a family to raise want to go with you now.
Yeah.
And from nothing to the level he's reached is, it's actually not really my achievement, it's his.
Yes,
but,
yes.
But it's something that makes me very happy.
If you can nurture it as well, if you can see it.
I've seen it happen from that to this and to hand over to that man and to hand it over to someone I regard pretty damn close to me is a very special thing.
You know, you train these people up and then they come and take your job.
It is about time someone took it.
Just a couple more comments. We've still got comments coming in. Thank you. Oh, I know I'm awesome. Thank you, Gaynor. Thank you. Rob's best is saying that there's a pamphlet here. What's a pamphlet?
No, that's Rob's. Rob's is the daughter of another great friend of mine, Noel Pamphlet.
Oh, I see, yes, yes.
Who lives in Durban.
Tuft Water says, sorry, sir, you're still out. There we go.
Oh, God. Oh, God. That story. Is Tufty Warner played cricket in that great cricket side of ours at Old Grey.
Yeah.
And we were winning games so easily that in one particular game, I'd said to Tufty, he was in next. I said, Tufty, when you go out there, I'm telling you now as captain, your first ball that you face, you have to swing for six. I'm not asking you to block. You have to swing for six.
Okay.
Anyway, he did that and got bowled first ball.
Oh, dear. Okay.
I was in next, and as I walked past Tufty, Tufty said, same rules apply.
Okay.
So, that's fine.
Yeah.
So, I swung myself off my feet. Yep. But then jammed my bat down.
Okay.
The keeper stumped me.
Oh.
And I looked the keeper in the eye and I said, you bloody fool, my bat was down long ago. And he said, yes, sir, but look down, it's still out.
You missed it.
So I had to go as well.
Sorry, sir, you're still out. I love that. I love that. Jackson, tell a story about your naughty lip.
Oh, God.
Is that a bad story?
No, it's not. It's one of my early repping days when I was still with Food Corps selling ProNutro and Elova syrup. And
listen, I supported you guys. I think I ate ProNutro every morning until I was 25.
I was a junior rep and not really that focused on what I was supposed to be doing. But I called on a Mrs. Radloff, who was, believe it or not, was a Chinese lady in the Quigney in East London.
Okay.
And I love calling her Mrs. Radloff because she referred to herself as Mrs. Ladloff. And remember, I sold products that were perfect for her inability to say certain words.
Yes.
So she had one of those old dealers.
Yeah, yes, so general dealer.
General dealer. So she had her stock at the back and then she'd call a product out.
Yeah.
And then she'd call the stock and I'd write it down. And I loved calling on her because I knew it was going to be fun.
Yes.
And she used to say,
Plonuclo Legula Pavameglem. One, no order.
What?
Plonuclo Banana Pavameglem. Half, one order. And I knew that was one case. Then okay. She got to the best part. Ilovo Lilip.
Lilip.
Ilovo Syrup.
Yeah.
And then Clotas Glelly Strawberry. And by the time I was finished that call,
yeah.
I was hysterical.
Yeah.
And then I'd go back to the office, and this one particular occasion, I arrived back at the office, and the lady that did our admin, June Beaumont,
yeah.
said, she was hysterical. She said, Mrs. Radloff's just phoned. She said, don't send Naughty Lip. He just laugh.
Naughty Lip. Naughty Lip.
So that's what that
shit's
about.
Gabby, what about my ducks? What? A chavi. Is it chavi?
Yeah, no chavi.
What about my ducks? I don't know what that is. Rochelle van Onslin, my ex-head girl, that was there as well. Like reading the stores in Paris. Mentioned. You've also had some gins, have you? Rochelle. Thank you.
Caller.
Caller.
Coffin business.
Coffin business. Did you have a coffin business?
Yeah, we did.
Yes.
Yeah, no, we did. That was scary.
I'm sure.
That was in the early days of my agency business. And at that time, I mean, my very first month, I remember my ex-boss came to see me. He'd warned me. He said, you're not going to make it in the agency business. And he'd come down to see me. And Zell and I took him out for supper after the very first month. And I said, my bad. You said I wasn't going to make it. I broke even in my first month. Broke even. And then that night after we had gone home, I sat bolt upright in bed at about 3 a.m. and I woke Zell up and I said, you know, I just told Alan Pierce that we broke even, but I forgot something. I haven't paid myself yet.
All your time and everything. Yeah.
So at that point, Mike Atkinson, my very good partner from the early days, had joined me and we were taking anything on. At that stage, we were already selling funeral wreaths and all sorts of shit.
Yes.
Those artificial ones.
Yes.
But then I got what I thought was going to be the best business we'd ever had. We got coffins. But they were do-it-yourself coffins. So they
were... Oh, when I say get in yourself.
No. They were in like boxes like this. Right. So you just put them together.
Like IKEA.
So you could warehouse a whole heap of these things at little cost.
Okay.
That was the key because warehouse space for coffins is not so good. So,
coffins, like this.
And then you just put them together.
Okay, good.
I even got Mr. Headbush.
Yeah.
The biggest funeral,
funeral guys,
on the planet, TNT.
Huge.
He was interested and he arrived. And I'm telling you, if he'd placed his order that day,
there'd have been millionaires.
We were away.
Okay.
But he asked us one question that Etty and I hadn't considered.
Yeah.
How do you put this thing together?
Oh dear. Yeah.
So I turned to Etty and I said, Etty, put one of those things together.
Yeah.
And after 10 minutes, I realized Etty was never going to get this right. And I definitely wasn't. So I walked around the corner and started laughing. And I was standing behind this big gondola. Sort of racking, and I was literally crying. I was laughing so much while Etty was swearing and trying to put this thing together. And Mr. Headbush eventually got that agency himself and made a fortune.
Oh really? Yeah, okay. See, he knew how to do it.
He said it was a good idea, but he just knew how to put it together.
Okay.
We didn't know that.
Shit.
But I remember screaming with laughter. It was the most sad day of our lives, but it was funny.
Just couldn't do it. Self-help. There we go. Love you, Gavin Hobbs, Blondie. Gaynor's having a good laugh there. Robert Kane says, absolutely go. Ian Lee's having a lost with the biggest bladder in the world. Are you right?
It's getting smaller. It's getting smaller.
We're nearly there. We're going to do the competition now. Gavin Noon saying, well done. Thanks, Gav, for coming on. Kevin Kruger.
Jeez, Kevin Kruger.
Wendy, thank you. Thanks so much, man. And I love those photos. Wendy sent me pictures of her bunny girl outfit that she had.
Yeah. The Playboy party. Kelly Chandler arrived as a priest and his missus arrived as a prostitute.
Yeah, okay. It's one of those parties. It looked like a proper 80s party.
That was a proper party.
Playboy deodorant vibes. Hey! Keith Clark saying Mark had pushed great liquor yeah. as well. Fantastic.
Well, he had the money to buy all that liquor.
Yes,
let's
he did.
Be
from all his coffins.
From all the coffins that he sold. The bastard.
Oh, but thank you so much. It's been
thank you, Gino.
Kevin, it's been magic.
No, thank you, my
good old stories. I love it.
Hopefully I haven't kept you too long.
No, it'd been beautiful. Beautiful. Rob saying
Gary, thanks, guys.
And what we do now is we do the competition. And so we've got a case of Fitch and Leeds, guys. Everybody that's online now, you have a chance to win the Fitch and Leeds. I'm going to play a song on the drums here. We put on the drum cam and it gets loud in here. It gets loud in here. So stick your headphones on if you want.
I'm going for a leap.
All right. So thank you for joining us. It's been fantastic. I'm going to put this on the drum cam. I want the name of the song and the artist if you can get it. First one to get it in the comments. If you haven't won as well for 90 days, you can win again. And the first one to do it wins a case of Fitch and Leeds sent to you by Gary DeBrain, Fitch and Leeds and the guys. Thank you so much.
Here we go.
Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you, Gav. That was great. I'm glad your bladder held out. It didn't. Oh, fantastic. Thanks, guys, for joining us. Thank you to Fitch and Leeds, our sponsor, and thank you to Spar, of course, as well as our internet provider, Amovia. They have been fantastic throughout this time as well. And Grace from Bad Cats. And Keith, JC, we love the punters. Thanks, man. Thanks so much, Gav. It's been fantastic. That was great. That was great, and we'll see you guys again on Tuesday. On Tuesday, indeed. Next Tuesday, we're going to have you. I'm not sure if we know who's on yet, but we got a lovely guest for next Tuesday. Surprise! Thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Sit down. Coming out of BE Town. Well, drink, find a shot. Never mind your liver, get to Gino Spot.
Gino Spot!
Get to Gino Spot.